Okay, looks like I'm ready to start. Let me just shortly check here. Okay, looks good. Looks good to me. Yes, I think I'm gonna start now. Oh wait, oh wait. Give me a second, need to set the title first. Okay, here we are. Awesome. Okay, now I'm ready to start. Let's begin. I hope you can all hear me. If not, let me know in the chat. I will periodically check it, if possible. And with that said, I think we just start into the first game I'm gonna cast today, which will be a CVC. Okay, so today I'm gonna cast a round of 16 and round of 8 from my tournament, which we just played last week. And tomorrow I will cast the rest of the tournament, so it will be semifinals and the finals, of course. And of course there were a lot of good games. I just glimpsed in some of them and they were awesome. So let's not waste any more time here, spawning in the bottom right position. Game number one on Frozen Temple, as the pink circuit is smudgest. And his opponent spawning in the top left position of Frozen Temple, as the red circuit is Burst Command. That's a very interesting deco, look at that. Oh yeah, very interesting. Oh well, okay. So we do have a ZVZ. And, oh, one drone there. I think we could go for some music. The only thing I need to fix then is get the music a little bit more quiet. Okay, so I think now it should be fine. If not, let me know. I can totally fix everything. Okay, so for Burst Command it looks like we have a hedge, gas, pool, which is an opening you can play against Terran as well. And for Smudgest, well, it looks like we have a pool before hedge, so that's already a difference here. I'm not sure what you want to have changed. I'm really sorry, currently. From stream source, too much lag. Oh! I don't think that I can change that, sadly. Because my stream is not well known enough. I don't have enough viewer and follower. So you can't set it differently, and I can't set it down now as well. So I'm really sorry. But don't worry, the VOD will be available on Twitch and on YouTube as well. So if you can't watch it now, which will be sad of course, but you can rewatch it later. So yeah. Smudgest going with some circlings across the map just to poke for now, which is fine. His speed is not even started and he needs to be very careful. Right here, doesn't want to lose any circling at the moment. Oh, one overlord just might die here. Second queen pops out, I think. Yes. And Overlord gets killed and Smudgest is supply blocked. Is throwing down a spine crawler here to be safe. I'm not sure if he did see speedlings, but he saw the baneling nest, so he knows he needs to be prepared at some point. And I think the music is still a bit too loud. Let's go down to 15. 16, whatever. Okay. Yeah, burst command. So far, both player actually are quite equal. Burst command is a little bit ahead in army supply. But he's committing with the banelings. And if he doesn't find any damage, then that could be very bad for him. Okay, interestingly, Smudges is going for a roach worm and getting the plus one missile attack, but so far no roaches at all, and he totally skipped speedlings. And there are no banelings as well. I feel like Smudges is in a lot of trouble. If the banes get the connects, the Zeke, then that's a lot of trouble. And there come the banes! Ooh, carefully! So far not too bad, but get the connections he wants! Almost. Oh, this is a real mess. He gets some drone kills there. But overall, very nice defense. Wow! That was really nice defense out of Smudges here. And now he's ahead. He got more army, slightly better attack, I would say. Speedling upgrade is coming out as well. And he's moving across the map. The Overlord out of burst command is spotting it, however. And on the other side on the map of the map, yeah, Spinecrawler and lots of speedlings. I'm not sure if he should hide the speedlings behind there. Maybe it would be smart to go for some flanking move, but maybe he can hold on. With the Spinecrawler, they deal extra damage against armor type units, so roaches are armor type. He should be fine, I guess. But if Smudges can soft contain him long enough and take his third behind, what he's doing right now, while getting the lair as well. So burst command not getting the lair tech so far, but Smudges got himself the lair tech, and he's getting the third best as well. Roach speed fired up now as well. And Smudges is turning back. I'm not sure why exactly, but maybe he's scared of all the circlings, and yeah, losing all the roaches would be bad. So it's a nice decision to move back. What I really like is Smudges going for the creep spread. I'm sure it does help your opponent as well because of the speed, but it grants you vision. And that's nice to have. So worker-wise, it's looking fairly even. And the hatchery from burst command is a little bit later than Smudges, but should be fine. Double Evo chamber for burst command. Okay. Later on this will be very useful. I do like the changeling here to spot everything, scout the timing of the lair. If he did click it, he wouldn't see the bar, but does he go up again? At least he knows it's coming. Huge link flood. Let's see how much damage they can find. If they could cancel the hatchery, that would be so huge. And they get the wraparound, and that's a dead hatchery. Smudges out of position, not paying attention. Close cancel. But that was really good damage. Burst command now ahead with his timing of the third base. That was really nice. It's really sad, Naminator. I don't know how I could change the quality now for you to be able to stream it or to watch it. If the option on my stream is not available, then I can't do much about it currently. That's the sad thing, because my stream is too small. If I would have more follower, more viewer, etc., then this option should be there, I guess. But currently that's not how it is, and I don't know why you got lag and what your internet connection is like. But normally most people nowadays are capable of watching on 720p quality, which is normal HD. So Burst Command now going across the map again after he cancelled the third base, which is just now to be retaken, and Smudge just doesn't quite see it. What is the army looking? 10 Mutalisk! Oh, that's really good for Smudges. It takes the Mutalisk a while. Oh, they're moving across the map. They just missed the army and will be out of position. So maybe we will get some base trade here? Or maybe not. Burst Command now coming back with his army, but what does he want to achieve with it? Ravager, Banelings and Roaches are not particularly good against Mutalisk. But the Queens are doing a good job so far. With the extra range, nice knife on the Spore. And yeah, that was really good for Smudges here, buying himself some time. But here's the counterattack. Mutalisk fighting a Spore Crawler. Okay, getting it. But this attack, can he hold? Good position on the ramp, but the Banelings finding huge connections here. Just, all the army dies. Out of Smudges. Now 50 supply behind. The Mutalisk are still dealing some damage, yes, but that's not enough. It's simply not enough. The natural falls, all the drones get killed. He's coming back, but actually I think Burst Command just bursted through and killed Smudges in game number one. The Mutalisk might be able to clean this up, but still then, it's looking not very healthy for Smudges. He has a huge bank, yes, and that's nice. Oh, he's losing the spawning pool as well, but he can't spend it. And as soon as those links they will definitely kill the hatchery. Definitely. At least they should. There we go, GG! Burst Command takes game number one. Nice. Good, so let me set up game number two between those guys. Both were platinum last week when those games were played. And here we are. Wait, that was wrong. There we go. Okay, spawning on Frost Lad Edition in the bottom left position as the Red Zerg. It is Burst Command. And his opponent spawning in the bottom right position as the Pink Zerg. It is Smudges. So let's see what those two players are up to. Currently they are just scouting with the Overlord and a drone. It's really difficult with the video quality. I mean, I would need to restart the stream, get all the settings down, and after that put them up again. And it's also bad because why should I stream on lower quality for all the people who want to watch? It's just bad. I don't know which internet bandwidth you have, but if you have at least 6K download, then you should be fine. If you don't run Skype and everything else which needs bandwidth, you should be fine with 6K. It should be fine. So I don't know what exactly your bandwidth is. So That's really sad. I'm really sorry for you. But it wouldn't make any sense to lower the stream quality, you know? It doesn't make any sense. Just imagine Pro League would go on to 360, which they at some point did, or Star League. It just looks awful. You can't see anything. It's no fun to watch at all. So I still think it would be better to just wait then for the VOD if you really can't watch it for whatever reason. And then you have later good quality content. I think that's just better, to be honest. Interestingly, burst command going here for the quick evolution chamber. So we could see some speedlink drops potentially, but I assume not in CVC. It should be just for a regular upgrade, maybe melee attacks, what she likes. Let's see what he's firing up here. Any second now, maybe. As much as he's going for a roach worm here and one evolution chamber himself. That's interesting. Worker wise they are looking even so far, which is also nice, but this drone, no, it should get away. It should get away. It should get away, yes, it will get away. Or will it? Oh! That, no, now it's gonna die, oh wow. On the other hand, our overlord dies here for as much as so. He needs to get another one done. And that hurts, that really hurts. There shouldn't be any lag, to be honest. I have... No, there shouldn't be any lag. That's strange. If it's lagging for other people as well, then okay, maybe I need to do something then against this, but there shouldn't be any lag at all. So I do hope it's only lagging for you. Smudgest going for the lair now, which is really nice. In the last game, going for fast Mutalis didn't win him at all, sadly. I think he skipped the Banelings, which was maybe a mistake. Finding this overlord is nice, and he should get it. The queens do have a nice range. Yeah, they get the overlord. Wow. And here, burst command again. With the burst command. Lots of circlings, some banelings. Interesting morphing location. Will take the banes some time before they can get there. It should be fine. So he's going in. We'll see this good position on the roaches. If they don't move too far out, the only thing are the banes. Yes, banes are not awesome against roaches, but oh, I like that move. Getting the roach at the front to tank and chip away on the banelings. But yes, as I wanted to say, banelings, if they get good connections, if everything clumps up, then they can fight. Oh, going straight for the drone line. Very good damage. Wow. Losing a lot of army here, but kills 10 drones. Was it worth it? That's the big question. So, maybe. But I think he wanted to have more damage. There are 8 more roaches coming out soon for Smudgest. He's moving across the map, he has a +1 attack. And there is not much back at home to defend for burst command. He's throwing down double evo chamber, which is good, can buy him some time. And double spine is also quite good, but with the additional roaches coming... Interestingly, Smudgest is going for 3 spines, almost walling off here. Very interesting position. But here come the roaches! And yeah, that's not a good position for the circlings to fight, because they don't find any surface area. But you can see how much damage banelings do to roaches if they clump up. But in this case, it should not be enough. It's looking very tough for burst command. He doesn't get the best around with the circlings. The broodlings are helping here out quite a bit, but roaches, man, they are so tanky, and there is not much left for burst command. At all. Can he hold on? 10 zerklings and 7 more roaches are coming out soon. But this hatchery might just fall here. Reinforcements have arrived, pulling the drones. As much as he's pulling back for now, but he's dealing so much damage, which he actually also needs to do. A random queen joins the battle as well. It's so close. And good transfuse here. I think Smudge has just barely got this fight. Yes, he breaks through and will get the hatchery here and potentially win game number 2. Last ditch effort out of Burst Command. No, that's not enough. CVC lol, GG! And we should see, there we go. And Smudge takes game number 2. Alright, loading into game number 3 of this best of 3 on Apotheosis Letter Edition. Spawning in the top left position of Apotheosis Letter Edition as the Red Zerg. It is currently 1-1. It is Burst Command. And he is playing against the pink Zerg spawning in the bottom right position. Smudgest! A very early pull out of Smudgest here, interesting. And Burst Command going for the hatchery as it looks like. So already a different opening for both player. Very interesting. I don't know why you would choose an opening like that on a map that large. But maybe Smudgest just wants to be safe. And going for pool first is safe. So the hatchery, his hatchery will be 20 seconds later, but it's not the biggest deal. If he is safe and can macro out of it, then he should be totally fine. Burst Command's drone. Getting in, scouting a little bit. Did he see the gas? No. So you want always check for the gas, of course. And yeah, Burst Command behind that, going for hatch gas pool himself. That's not bad. Yes. Okay, so just getting something sorted out here with the quality. Burst Command so far going for 6 Zerglings, up to 8 in total. Oh, you don't want to lose the Zerglings! Wow, that was so close! No, don't lose them! Run! Smudgestlings, run! Interestingly, Smudgest speed will hit later, although he went for pool first. That's very unique, in my opinion. Burst Command going for the Evo Chamber. Behind that again. Might find an Overlord killed, which is so good for him. You don't want to waste your Overlords. So normally you might be able to sneak in the Zergling for scouting. But yeah, as Burst Command was going for Bailing Bust all over the games, 1 and 2, I understand Smudges wants to scout this, to be able to be sure that's not coming here, Bailings, again, you know. What I really like out of Smudges is his creep spread. He is starting creep quite early, connecting bases, that is really nice. And he's going for Roachhorn himself. So, melee attack, no, missile attack, sorry, for Burst Command, and Lair are starting up at the 4-minute mark. Good timing, I would say. And some speedlings are moving across the map. Nice. Just scouting around, seeking for any damage, but Smudges is prepared. Look at the army supply, 8 against 19. On the other hand, that means that Burst Command has more worker. In the long run, that sure should help him. Ah, Burst Command losing on Overlord right now as well. Okay. And wasting some Zerglings too. Smudges this time going in with the Baneling Nest, adding 16 more Zerglings. And this could deal a lot of damage. He's not quite killing the rocks for now, but that's fine as well, I would say. He's scared of losing the Zerglings. Okay, I see. Very careful here. Oh, another Overlord gets sniped. 3 Evolution Chambers, Spinecrawler. Yeah, he wants to be safe. Ah, some Zerglings trapped outside of the wall. But I like the wall. So, Burst Command identifies what's coming, even though he didn't scout the Baneling Nest, but he knows, okay, so many Zerglings, something has to be up. And he's right, he's completely right. So let's see if this wall can hold strong or not. Or if Smudges is committing, he doesn't have to. He could just be like, nope, not gonna commit. And just take a third base, yes, but this one is under fire, it's under attack. And it might get cancelled here. The Zerglings was much just so far out of position, nothing to defend. But the DPS, oh, it's so close, but I think he has to cancel. I do think he has to cancel this hatchery! Close cancel, but nice juke with the drone. Still, oh, nice save. Really well done. Awesome. But at least it gave Burst Command some time. On the other hand, Burst Command is on 2 base and he's playing 2 base Lurker, so okay. I never saw Lurker against Speedlings and Banelings, but Smudges so far is going for Roaches himself, so it could be okay going for Lurker here. Smudges, however, is, yeah, he's banking up a lot of minerals. He never got the gas geysers on the 3rd and the 4th base, which is a mistake in my opinion. He has just way too many minerals, so what you should do now is grab all the gas. He's on 1 gas the entire game so far. On Lair Tech, you can't be on 1 gas. And just now saturating. Yeah, take the gases, take all the gases, get a macro hatchery. Wants to go for an Overlord drop, and that's a very smart decision in my opinion. That's really, really smart. But he needs to morph it, that means he needs gas, which he currently is very low on. But I like the idea behind it. And Burst Command going for a little bit of a riskier play with the hatchery at the gold base. So here we see the Overlord morphing. The first Hydroliths are coming out in this game. And maybe they will morph into Lurker immediately, but I think for now that's not the case. He needs more gas before he can start doing that. And there we go, speedling drop. Let's see how much damage he can find. 8 Zerglings. There's 1 queen. Ah, goes for the queen. The position of the queen is good, but the Zerglings get a wrap around. Hydralis are coming here to defend, but the queen gets taken out. And killing a queen for 8 Zerglings? Yep, I would say that's a fair trade. Ooh. Ah, this Overlord dies. I also think you don't want to have a drop overlord morphed into an overseer. Overseer can't drop, so that's a little bit of a waste of money in my opinion. And the game slows down for now. 5 lurk, however, on the way for burst command. And on the other side of smudges, we have the lurker, the Heyjo then himself, and additional circlings with the Spain speed upgrade. Okay. It looks like burst command finally moving across the map with a good 1-1 timing, some lurker and a bunch of roaches, and there are the rest of the lurker. And ooh, if he gets the prime position on this ramp, that would be a good start to this fight. Let's see how this goes. So it is 1-1 upgrades against 0-0. Now Smudge sees that he could react. Oh, lurker burrowing. Oh, the damage is huge. There's no detection, however. The queen might die as well. Look at the damage the queen took. Wow! And now Smudges is boxed in. He's getting sieged. And how do you break out of it? It's very difficult with the lurker chipping away on the your units and spinecrawler. He tries to go for the wraparound, crushing in with the banings, but the lurker are so strong. I think that's not enough, and burst command might just win right now, right here. Burrowing again, just pushing forward, bursting through Smudge's defenses, killing the hatchery, and dealing so much damage to Smudge's here. Doubling the supply, and yeah, those circlings won't find any damage as well. This counterattack is nice, but there should be enough to defend back at home. So many overseer. Wow. But yeah, they will all get taken out. Nice counterattack, but Smudges is behind by 100 supply. And I feel like he... I think that's game. He's so far behind, he can't hold any of his bases. There we go, GG, well played. And Burst Command wins the first series. Nice. Very good game so far. Quite interesting CVCs we had. And now it's time for a TVT. TVT is next. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, best of three, the second series I'm gonna cast today between those two guys in green spawning in the top left position of Frozen Temple. It is Stimmeister. And he's playing against the blue Terran for Team Kings. It is Nemiator, which is currently going for a gas first, and an SCV scout, which is a bit early in my opinion, but it's okay. Better safe than sorry. And he's going with the gas first. And Stimmeister as well. However, Nemiator is behind by one SCV already. Somehow he missed to queue up one SCV. Or is he? No, yeah, he's behind. He's behind one SCV so far. Stimmeister's SCV is scouting. Sees, okay, was gas first. But no second gas taken, so he shouldn't worry too much. As it is quite unlikely that there's something special going on. Or anything cheesy for now. And let's see, we should see a factory soon, but for now it's the Reaper. Okay, Stimmeister going now with the second refinery. A bit late, in my opinion. And on the other hand side, Naminator going for a second barracks. Okay. And now he has an idle SCV here, waiting for minerals to be done. Yeah, if you go gas first, I would not recommend an opening like this. You have so much gas in your bank, which is doing nothing for you currently. So either you commit, or you don't at all. Don't do half things. Naminator's Reaper moving across the map might just be able to jump in. At the same time, Stimmeister's Reaper is going out. Oh wow, they missed each other completely. And I think Stimmeister has now to turn back, which he will do. Good focus fire out of Naminator. Gets one. Maybe a second kill. Oh, almost. But this mule is inactive for quite some time, which is a huge mistake as well. Oh, but if Naminator loses this Reaper. Not the best micro out of Stimmeister, and the Reaper gets away. Wow. That's really unfortunate for Stimmeister here. And Stimmeister still on one base. He didn't get starport in time. He doesn't get a command center so far. This mule will expire soon. So this one Reaper dealt so much damage. Even if it only killed one SCV, but it killed quite a lot of... it pulled a lot of attention. Double helium production, and back at home we have an early stim, quite early stim, for the Naminator factory, another refinery, so he might go for a stim timing here. And finally Stimmeister's command center is coming down, nice. Stimmeister killing Naminator's Reaper, which is not too bad at all. Oh yeah, but there are 5 SCVs. Ah, Marines. So it's 6 now. It should be... Oh, now he's boxed in quite... Oh, gets away. Some nice splash damage on the Marines. It's looking quite even. If you consider Naminator went for a way early command center, but it's just now even in worker supply without losing one. So this macro, they're not the best. 4 Hellions however could deal lots of damage. On the other hand side, Marines are really powerful as well, and there are only 3 Hellions. Yes, however I do like the Cloak Banji. There's not much for Naminator to defend so far against a Cloak Banji. And this could deal a lot of damage. Potentially. There are no turrets. Those Hellions. Ooh, they are quite vulnerable. Yes, one gets sniped. Nice hit and run. Oh, losing so many Marines here. I have to say, Stimmeister is doing a really good job so far of harassing. Killing. Oh, yeah, line him up, line him up. Ooh, that's good damage. And the Banshee is coming in now as well. Just mules were dropped. Oh, that's not too good. This Banshee could kill the mules. Don't go for the Marines. Go for the mules. Ah, the Marines get healed. Should go for the mules. Those are very good targets to kill. The factory is still floating here. And Naminator abandoning his base completely. Going across the map with 2 medevacs and 5 Marines. But will he find enough damage? He pulls away the SCVs, and the Banji is working on the tech lab, which is also a mistake. Now it's on the hunt again on SCVs. And yeah, here we come. The medivacs. And Stim is ready. Stim versus no Stim, but there is a tank. And this tank is so strong. Back at home, a second Banji here, but double Viking finding a lot of damage here as well against the Banjis. But it's really looking bad for Naminator in this game. He lost so many SCVs. However, Stimmeister's macro is slipping quite hard as well. He doesn't go for the orbital command himself, so there is a way for Naminator to come back. Oh, those mules. Send them back to mining, please. Please. They are hugging each other. Look at that. Okay, okay. Enough. But yeah. Nemiator now. Now he realizes the mules. Okay. Break is over. Back to mining. And he needs all the mining he can get. I would love Nemiator going for combat shields himself soon. Ah, there's the Banshee again. And I did like that Stimmeister was waiting quite a bit to get some energy on the Banshee back. Interesting scan. Yeah, that scan was out of Stimmeister. Okay, I see. Good. Getting into the bunker. Still, I would say Stimmeister is ahead. He got the tanks, he got the marines without Stim so far, but he's getting combat shields now as well as Nemiator and plus one attack. So it's looking not too bad here. He got a Viking, more Vikings are coming. Now he's firing up the, following it up with the medivacs, which is good. He's a bit supply capped, and there is a. Not a huge drop, to be honest. It's a small drop with a lot of medivacs and some Vikings, but it could deal some damage. Nice scan to confirm where the army is, to make sure you can drop in. And there we go, big drop, right on top of the E-base, but fast reaction. Three Vikings against three Vikings. Yeah, Nemiator dealing massive damage here, but that's what he needs to do, because This drop is stranded, I would say. Oh, don't lose all the medivacs! Ooh, so close. So close. So he needs to pull back here. Overall, he did some good damage. And now it's even in terms of worker supply. He just needs to make sure he gets his army going. Oh no, don't lose the medivacs! Yeah, the Vikings! Don't lose the Vikings! Ooh, that hurts! Nemiator did stim there, right? He did. Oh yeah. He wanted to secure the kill with the marines, but it's okay. Another Viking flying across the map will get killed potentially! Yes! So Stimmeister scanning now. I do like that Nemiator is getting more production here. But where's his natural? He's going. He's adding 5 more barracks, so he's going up to 8 racks. But he is on 2 bases only, and you need to be on 3 bases in order to get up to 8 racks. Ooh, but Stimmeister not completing the production here, which is huge. I just missed a complete fight, I'm so sorry. But yeah, Stimmeister going in and winning the game right there. Let's watch the fight here, guys. Let's be fair. What just happened here? The Liberator was in siege, there are no tanks. Good position on the tanks, nice Stim in. And yeah, Stimmeister is just overwhelming in numbers here. And just wins straight up. GG, well played. Well done. Very well done. Good, then let's load into game number 2. Stimmeister just... wait, no, that's wrong. Stimmeister just won game number 1. And now we are in game number 2. Spawning in the bottom left hand side of Galactic Process. As the Red Terran, currently down 1 game, playing for Team Kings, it is Nemiator. And his opponent, who won game number one in the green trunks, in the top right hand position of Galactic Process, it is the Meister! Going for the gas first here, as well as Nemeator again. And Nemeator? No, he's fine. No, he's behind one SCV again. And I think that's because of his super early SCV scout. He's annoying here on that SCV, and that's good, delaying the barracks quite a bit, but doesn't scout for the gases so far, which he needs to do soon. Oh, will he get the SCV? No, he won't, but maybe he will? Benny Hill theme, where are you? And there we go. So, now Nemeator is ahead, one SCV. And he delayed the barracks by quite a bit, which was good for him, really good. Stimmeister's SCV going in, scouting around. So, not too much happening here. Oh, going back again. Just for scouting? Okay. Maybe. Instant tech lab, that's a very interesting choice. But you can do this. If you want to counter 3 Rex Reaper, going into Concussive Shell Marauder is a very good choice. And Stimmeister is going for the factory now, behind that. As well as Nemeator, okay. So far no Concussive Shells, huh. Interesting. Very interesting. The second Marauder, it is okay, you can open like that. But at some point you just might want to get the Concussive Shell upgrade as well. It's just good. Reaper gets a kill for himself, that's nice. And immediately the starport for Stimmeister. He still doesn't have an orbital command, which is a huge mistake. You wanna have that, ASAP, all the time. So this could hurt him a lot later on in the game. It's hurting right now as well. There we go, finally. Going with the orbital command. An interesting choice to go with one Hellion here and one Reaper only. And then he switches it up quite a bit. Okay. Still no Concussive Shells at all for Nemeator. But yeah, he gets the Reaper, that's nice. The Reaper, however, scouted quite a bit. Yes. Also saw the eBay, Nemeator still on one base. A very interesting build with all the Marauder and the Hellion and the Medivac coming up as well. And now he's going for a Stim. I still think he should have gone for the Concussive Shells first. If you open up Marauder, then you want to have that upgrade most of the time. It's just so good. Just imagine a Cyclone would hit the Marauder. Get a lock on and get away with it. But with Concussive Shells, maybe you can catch up and kill it. So Stimmeister going now for the command center and up to 3 barracks. But he's heavily supply capped. And there's only one Hellion and one Marine to defend. I think Nemeator hits a strong timing here, which could deal game ending damage. The Viking, however, is a really nice addition. There's nothing to shoot up, so the Viking can deny the Medivac quite a lot, but how do you deal with the Marauder? They're dealing quite some damage here. Viking chipping away on the Medivac, still. Yeah, the Marauder finding some good damage here. Oh, a tank coming across the map, a marine as well. The reactor gets killed here. This marine might just die as well. But the cyclone will pop out soon. Oh, the emergency repair, will it be enough? Yes, it will be enough. And there's the cyclone locking on to the Marauder, dealing massive damage. Liberator is out, Viking is out, Marauder are moving across here, the base, killing the... Oh, wow. The tank here, not in a very good position, gets killed as well. The Liberator is in a good position, however. And it... still very close. Yeah, the Liberator... A Banshee would be nicer to have here in this situation. But, oh no, don't go back into the Liberation Zone! Ooh, taking massive damage here on the Marauder. Behind that, he's muckering up. Just misclicked a little bit with the command center, but that's fine, he's finding some damage. And he's ahead in worker supply, so that's good for him. Yeah, the Liberator might just barely get a kill here. Ah, the medivac is out. Stim finished up as well for the Mediator, and he's kiting back quite good. Another Cyclone, however, should shut this down completely. Oh, that's very risky. Yeah, I think this push is over. Oh, especially when the medevac dies, nice scan to kill it off. But overall, Nemiator did a good job. He dealt quite some damage here. So let's see, yeah, Nemiator going for the bio play. He's queuing up quite a lot of marines as well, so... Ah no, he's still pushing across the map. Maybe Stimmeister should finish this barracks. Like ASAP, he needs all the production he can get. A tank would be nice as well. And he needs to get some Vikings or anything. But no, Nemiator is going back, he's fine. Still the Odal command. Oh, oh! Oh, one Liberator getting some kills here. Massive kills, to be honest. So, wow. Might get even more. Yeah, Liberator got killed. So that's... that as well, and now he's gonna. The interesting thing is maybe the barracks will burn. No, it will be fine. Close. Sometimes if the building is too low, it will burn after you finish it. So, but in this case, not the case. Yes, one SUV as well. Could build a bunker. Ha! There we go. Nice. Or maybe a turret as well. Viking against Viking Liberator Cyclone. The Viking of Nemiator should lose this fight. But this base, yeah, is forced to lift again. And slowly but surely Nemiator can push this even further and deal quite some damage. If he can lock Stimmeister here for quite some time, he might be able to just get himself in a good position and win this game. Good drop on the tank, the repair not happening. And that is good damage here. If he gets the second tank, which he will. Oh wow, Bio is so strong. The Viking gets destroyed. The Liberator, not in the best spot, gets killed as well. And I think Nemiator might just be... yeah, on edge to winning this. GG. Nemiator wins this game. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, game number 3 in this best of 3 series between those two guys. As we have spawning in the bottom right position of King Zhejong Station in the green trunks. It is Stimmeister! And he's playing against the red Terran spawning in the top left position of King Zhejong Station. Playing for Team Kings, it is Nemiator. Going again with the gas first. Which is a bit later than Stimmeister's gas first, but could be fine. Ooh, look at that. Proxy, proxy something. At some point, maybe it should be. So he wants to fake out Stimmeister here. And I don't think that Stimmeister will be able to read into that. There are so many SCVs missing, like two of them. It's very hard to see. But yeah, three racks opening potentially. Come on, where's the next barracks? This SCV is annoying. But Stimmeister going just for the gas first so far. And three racks can be very strong. Oh! He doesn't continue building the barracks. Go back! What? I think Stimmeister could be able to see that there are quite some SCVs missing if he looks at his side on the map and sees, wow, wait, I almost have double the amount of SCVs mining here. But he goes with the factory. There should be a Reaper up soon. Yeah, for Namiator it is Reaper opening. And 3 Rex Reaper. King's Hejong Station is not the best map for doing this, but it can work. It can work. Oh. Tension is building up here. Slightly displayed, misplaced supply depot here. But more importantly, we have the Reaper against. We have 3 Rex Reaper production against only 1 Reaper and 1 Hellion at a time. And I don't. Stimmeister needs to have very. Ooh, nice block there. Needs to have very good control in order to hold this. And the second Reaper from the back is coming in right now. That's a flanking move. However, it's not looking too bad for Stimmeister so far. Especially with the Hellion coming out as well, and the other Reaper. If he only would have microed a little bit better, he could have killed both of those. But so far he holds. The Hellion should be repaired. Don't chase too far. Yeah, Stimmeister doesn't know that it is indeed 3 Rex Reaper. And he's chasing quite a lot. This wall is closed. 5 racks in total. Wow! Wow, Namiator going for a huge one base attack. But these 3 Reaper, they will deal massive damage. And this is the complete wrong time to get your add-ons done. You can't defend without units. And I think going for the add-ons instead of units was the biggest mistake he could have done. He wasn't able to scout it for the scout it. And I don't think he will be able to defend this. 5 Reaper against 2 Reaper and a Hellion. That's not looking too good. Loses 1 Reaper there. And the Marines come out, which is nice, but they are not that great. Good grenades! Wow, massive grenades here. 6 Reaper now in total. The 7th Reaper coming up as well. There's only this Hellion and this 1 Reaper to defend, which is not enough. Cloak is nice, but you don't even have a Banshee. And the tank isn't good against that amount of Reaper as well. If it's sieged, yes, maybe. But unsieged, you will see what happens. The tank just gets killed. Even with the counter repair, the grenades. Oh, dealing so much damage here. And I think that's just game. Namiator should win. Right here, right now. GG well played. And Namiator wins this series. Good, then give me a second. Okay. Next series will start right now. Which is between those two guys, gold and platinum. The third series of today, ladies and gentlemen. We have spawning in the bottom right position as the yellow Protoss playing for the Drunken Outlaws. It is Lüblix. And he's playing against his opponent. The Blue Terran playing for himself, spawning in the top left hand position of Frozen Temple. It is AT-AT. With the gas first in this Wow. Okay, gas first against Protoss. That's something I would say you see not that often. And Löblix is scouting fairly early, to be honest. A normal scout would be after you plant down the gate, I think. But it's okay, you can be very annoying with this probe, potentially stealing some gas or doing anything. And yeah, you want to try to get the SCV, but you don't. That's sad. Oh, AT-AT with the scouting? No, going. Oh, this supply depot is way too early. Sure, the probe is now boxed in and you went for gas first, but still. If a Proto scouts it, then he scouts it. You can't really prevent that from happening. Same with Zerg. It's just, if you close the door too early, that screams like something is up. More than if you would just scout it. And there we go, instant factory. And for Löblix, the Nexus. And still some gas. Only two guys in the gas so far. And there we go with the Cybernetics Core. The probe's still alive. Actually, there is no real need to chase the probe around. For now, the Marine will take care of it. At least should. And I'm curious to see what AT-AT is up to here. What is he gonna do? Is he gonna play Cyclone? Or maybe an aggressive tank push? He needs to find some damage at least. Yeah, there we go, Tech Lab. He's not producing much out of the barracks so far. Maybe he's waiting for the reactor. No, he's going for another Marine. So he lost quite some production here and he needs to find some damage with this attack. Otherwise he won't be able to win this game, most likely. So now just the command center starts when Löblix Nexus finishes. And ooh, Löblix going for a second gate and a robotics facility here. Could go for a third gate as well. Potentially. I think that's quite standard nowadays. So either you go for one gate and Robo and Twilight, I would say, or you go for three gates and Robo, or three gates and Twilight, something like that. Or maybe Stargate. So one tech building, three gates, or one gate and two tech buildings, I think is the way to go as Protoss nowadays in TVP. And AT-AT is supply capped heavily. He doesn't really get his timing done. He won't find any damage, I guess, because he's not able to constantly produce units. And Löblix Nexus is finished. Oh wow. And there we go, third gate. Could have thrown it down way earlier, but it's fine. The Mothership Core not in the worst position as well. I would love to have a pylon at the front soon for Löblix. But he's scouting with Adept, and that's good. And the Shade gets in. Ooh, no. That is sad. Oh, he lets it finish to kill some SCVs. And there, oh yeah, he needs to pull the SCVs there. That's not what you want to do, but the Adept only gets two kills. And forces to pull all. The Adept that did some good damage, I have to say. Did some okay damage. However, the tank evac. Oh. I thought he would boost across the map, but he's not, okay. So the tank evac could have dealt a lot of damage. There's the pylon. And so far, no new tech structure. No Twilight. There we go. There we go. Observer makes its way across the map, which is good. And for AT-AT, oh, factory play. We will see some gold level mech here. Nice. I like that. I like that a lot. Playing mech against Protoss is a nightmare currently, in my opinion. But it's fun to watch. It's super fun, especially when it works. And I do hope it will work. That would be so awesome. And yes, you can win with mech against Protoss. It is possible. Definitely. But Löblix got some scary units moving across the map. Stalker, Immortal, a Warp Prison will join this as well soon. Yes, there are only 3 gates behind, but still. What does Lüblix have to defend? This tank is so vulnerable! No! Gets killed. Yeah, there's the Cyclone. Not the best lock-on, but I think it's okay. But what does he have to defend? Not much. And Lüblix sees this. He knows what's going on here. Does he see the tank, however? No. Okay. But the War Prism is ready. 3 more gates are coming. This is some 2-base attack out of Lüblix. He's supply cap, but if he trades away some of his stock, he can warp in again, which he's doing right now. He just goes in, kills the tank, no medivac micro, and AT-AT just taps out, knows he is defeated. Ah, Lüblix just did hit too early here in this game. Okay guys, I need 1 minute break, and then I will continue the cast. Looking forward to it. That one. See you in a minute. And I am back. So let's continue the cast and jump into the next game right now. Awesome. It is still best of 3. Lüblix up 1 game. Okay. Spawning in the bottom left hand side of Galactic Process, playing for the Drunken Outlaws as the yellow Protoss, it is Lüblix. And his opponent spawning in the top right hand side of Galactic Process, playing for himself, currently down 1 game as the blue Terran, it is the AT-AT. So for AT-AT this time, no gas first build. He's going with the Rex into gas, which is a normal opening. And Lüblix going for the gate into gas as well. And his early scout, which he loves to do so much. Yeah, Lüblix being really annoying here. But this time, he's not getting a kill, I think. No. No chance. Reaper out of AT-AT and a standard Nexus for Lüblix. So that's totally fine. Standard command center timing out of AT-AT as well. So potentially we might just see a longer game today. Now. Right now. It would be so cool to see AT-AT try mech again. But after the first game, I think that's very unlikely. Lüblix probe gets killed. which is a little bit unfortunate, but it's okay. And follow up with the reactor. There's the Reaper. So far only one gate. Now saturating the gases. We might just soon see some kind of tech. Some miss rally with the probes, which is very unfortunate. However, the Stalker will finish up just in time to deflect the Reaper, which can't jump up here, has to go there, which is very interesting. And yeah, there's the Stalker. Look at that, the Reaper can't jump up here. Even though that's better, there are more steps, I would say, but it's not possible. A second gate here, and still no tech, no Robo, no Twilight, that's a bit strange. Maybe it's fine. Who knows? There we go. There we go. Oh, and we do see Hellions and a really early command center. A really early third command center. Wow. That is quite something. Okay, so AT-AT going with the greed here, losing the Reaper. But it's okay, I would say. And those Hellions, maybe they will find some good damage. However, Hellions are not really good against Stalker, and they are not super awesome against Adepts. You might think so, but Adepts and Hellions, they deal quite a lot of damage to each other. So, yeah. That's hard to tell. But we do see mech again, out of AT-AT as it looks like. Second factory comes out. Nice. So Löblix with the Adept. The Adept could get killed. Potentially. And it should. Yep. Toasted. Bam. So now Löblix should know that this is not normal. Some kind of mech play has to come. Or at least some kind of mech opener. He's taking the third base, which is good. But it's later. It's later than AT-ATs. So let's see how much damage those Hellions can find. There is double photon overcharge available. The Hellions not finding any damage, and that was not really good. Sad. Really sad. Yeah, he realizes that did hurt. Oh, double observer placement. Very interesting. Ah, he realizes. Okay. So the game slowing down a little bit, but Löblix going with the three robos. Wow! He's like, if you play mech, I do the same. Robo only. If that works, I don't know. But Löblix might wanna go in there? No, he's with the observer and is like, maybe not now. And I think that's smart. Seven Stalker, they could, yeah, with the Widow Mines, that's not gonna work. If you would have blink, yes, you could do it. But still, oh, I like the missile turret placement. And he just might get the observer here. If Löblix doesn't pull attention here and pull it away, come on. No, this one is gonna die. Widowmine got the kill. Nice. But there's another observer right on top of this army, so Löblix still sees something. And now he has the triple robo, but can't really produce out of it. I mean, he would have some money to do so, but not enough currently. He needs to macro up just a little harder before he will. I still think going up to two robos would be better. And currently he's just using two of them. He's going heavy into Immortal. You would like to have a forge eventually. Ah, there we go. There it is. Okay. And against mech, I think you don't want to have the armor level. The armor upgrade. I do think the weapon upgrade would be better in this case. Like in TVP, in PvP, most of the time I think you get the attack upgrade as well. And against Terran mech, I think you should do the same there too. In this game, however, AT-AT's macro looks way better. It does look way better. So, and he's staying quite safe as well. He should spread out his tanks a little bit, grab the watchtowers. But he got the center turret at least, that's good for him. And Stalker without Blink are not that good against mech. Now Blink is on the way. And that's one thing Lurblix really needs. But I don't think he can go up this ramp at all. I don't know how he should be able to do this. Yes, the Widowmine gets a huge shot! As well with the tank fire there. And yeah, Lurblix can't go up. It would have been smart if Lurblix would have realized, okay, this guy is going heavy into tank Hellion. And instead of, you see one Stargate already, instead of going into triple Robo, just go into Stargate. Triple Stargate, go into Tempest for example. Or even Void Rage can work. With maybe Zealots? Charge Lords? Who knows? Double scan comes down, sees a lot. Which is good. And there we go, triple Stargate for Lurblix. So he has quite some tech. All he needs would be the fleet beacon now. Potentially there's the fourth base where you wanna have some gases as well. But that's good. Ooh, do you want to move down this ramp into 5-6 siege tanks? Potentially not. He has quite some army. He needs to spread out. But now those Hellions are Hellbats, gaining a lot of more life. I think it's 45 and some nice damage boost as well. And look at AT-AT. He is up in army supply, up in worker supply. He's maybe a little bit too... Yeah, he produced a little bit too many SCVs, but he's doing this quite nicely. Counterattacks, however, would deal massive damage against him. Like, there is potential to deal some damage against a mech player. Quite a lot, to be honest. So maybe Lurblix should capitalize on that fact. And he's going into Fleet Beacon Charge Lord. He wants to move down the ramp, but that's not what you can do. Aggressive Blink into Hellbat and tanks. I don't think that that's a good move to do. Most barriers are popped now as well. And he's still fighting in the Hellbats. He wants to get the tanks, but the Hellbats are buffering so good, dealing massive damage. And whoa, that did hurt a lot. Just imagine AT-AT would just move across the map now. But he's taking himself the time he needs. He just took a major win. If he would saturate the gases, that would be awesome. Same goes for Lurblix here. You need the gas as Terran mech player. You could go into Raven, which would be so helpful, especially against Tempest. Raven is awesome with the PDD, it helps a lot. Oh wow, big gateway explosion. I really do like that Lurblix does not forget about his air weapon upgrades. He's getting shield upgrades as well. I think that's a bit too early. He's only on +1 armor, so he normally wants to have the other upgrades done first. This Hellion attack is sadly not killing any probes, but this attack could deal massive damage. The Hellbats were not being repaired. Ah, he doesn't go with all his army. That's a problem with mech. spreading out is not a good thing to do. Your mech is strong when you have a lot of units, like a lot of units. The more the better. And splitting up like that, leaving half your army at home, is normally not what you want to do. You want to have maybe two hellbats, two tanks and some turrets to be safe, and that's fine. That's totally fine. But having all those tanks back at home, look at that. How many tanks does AT-AT have? 19 tanks. I know he wished those tanks were AT-ATs, but sadly this is StarCraft and not Star Wars. Löbling's taking another base, which is fine, he needs that. Does he see the rocks being broken down? No. He doesn't know it. At all. He doesn't hear it. He's right there, but he doesn't know. He has no clue that this is happening. However, he warps in some Stalker. The upgrades are looking really good for AT-AT. He just needs to... Wow, that's how you take a base as Terran. Double command center and plant down 8 turrets. Bam! Nice! Oh, those armies, they can see each other barely. Look at that. Oh, nice siege up here. Oh, look at the damage the tanks are dealing here. That's some real damage, but that's the problem. He loses so many tanks. Yes, he does trade really good here, because he got the first shots off, there's no micro involved, out of Löblicks. And those helmets are killing a gateway. Wow, a warp gate. That's unique. But if only... Oh, wow, so many Tempests. If only he would have had all those tanks with this army, that would have been so good for him. Like, crazy good. Is it really a tat instead of AT-AT? You know, if you have something capitalized like big A, big T, big A, big T, then you normally spell it AT-AT. At least as I know, but maybe I'm wrong. I just stick with AT-AT. I think that's cool. So AT-AT would love to go into high impact payload with the Thor against the Tempest. There are 11 Tempest out and only 11 Viking. That's not good. He's going into 4 Thor, which is awesome. But he needs the high impact payload in order to deal massive damage against them. Because the Javelin missile launchers are not that great against the Tempest. And he doesn't have Raven for the PDD. Look at the damage! Wow! The damage from the Tempest is so huge. Yeah, and the range as well. It would be helpful for AT-AT to have the sensor to add a Xenara Watchtower. That would be so good. But there's a Widow Mine. So, we have some kind of stalemate here. I don't know if adepts are really good here. Ah, mothership, wow. Where is it? Where is it? There it is, the mothership. Having 6 attacks, dealing 7 damage. Without the cloak, it would be as useless as the battlecruiser. Oh, the Tempest dealing good damage here. And at some point, AT-AT needs to fight, which he's doing now. And Löblix is taking quite some damage. Ooh, nice. I think Löblix should have kited. If he would start kiting with his Tempest, then he would definitely take some good trades. But he's going in with the carrier. And those units, the carrier, you rarely see it. But in this game, that's why I love gold platinum games, you know? Or even platinum diamond. Sometimes you see stuff like that and it's so, so awesome. Oracle gets a revelation and gets away, wow, but losing all the Stalker is not the best thing here. Löblick's macro is slipping quite a lot. Good scan, the mothership goes down here. Didn't do much, to be honest. But the Tempests are dealing good damage. The Thor could fight this, but he's way too indecisive and taking a lot of damage unnecessarily here. Yeah, the upgrades are looking good for Löblix now, and I do think that Löblix might be able to just slowly win here this fight. And if there's nothing, you have to imagine, there are no Tempests. AT-AT has problems killing those. Even if he does kill them, the next step, the carrier awaits, and this will be even worse. There are three carrier out so far. Ah, Löblix going into Tempest again. And yeah, he's dealing a lot of damage. Good focus fire with the Vikings, but is it enough? It should be enough. Barely. Ah, the carrier coming. They don't have enough interceptor, however. Only 12 in total, while they could have 24, I think. Nice Hellion counterattack, dealing some damage at least, killing 5 probes. The Hellions almost killed the Nexus there. Look at that. They dealt really damage. So Löblix is taking a lot of bases. He got Storm ready, which is really helpful. It's not the best against Mech, but it definitely can help. It's not the worst thing to have Storm. Especially against Vikings, Storm is really powerful. At least sometimes. I do like the turrets. Oh, now we might just see a fight here to get the space. The Tempests are going in, the carrier are going in, launching the interceptors. But they all get killed here. And there are the Vikings now, but there are the Storm! Wow, massive Storms! Look at how good Storm can be against Vikings. But they all survive, so you can repair those and go in again, and that's what you should do now. Repair the Vikings, come on! There you go. This Thor is so dead. And the Vikings are not fully repaired, not even all fighting. You need to have more time. Widowmine, Thor, Viking. That's how you do it. And Brood of Widowmines! Brood of Widowmines! No, don't go back! Ah, you had the opportunity. Here you go. No Drilling Claw upgrade. Oh, the Widowmine! Close one. The Thor not in high impact payload mode. This wow. This is peaceful. This is really peaceful so far. Mining side by side. And here's war! Bam! The real war. I still don't know if AT-AT is winning or Löblix. I can't tell. I really can't tell for sure. I think Löblix can be okay, but his macro is not really up. The Widowmines, oh no. Oh no. Oh, that's expensive for Löblix there. And here comes the Vikings! With really nice upgrades, killing all the Tempests potentially. A good Stalker weapon, but sadly away from the Nexus. So those pilots don't have the warp conduit. And it takes those Stalker forever, like 11 seconds. Wow. However, there are no tanks left. So Stalker can be good again. And there are the turrets. Peace is over. Oh wow, turrets, adapts. Yeah, AT-AT missed the opportunity to kill this base, and now it's Löblix base. And there's a warp prison with 4 adapts heading towards the third base. Big attack incoming, some Widowmines will burrow underneath the Tempest. Don't get the connections, but the Vikings are dealing some good damage here. And this base will be dead. Look at the Thor. Bam, 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 bam. The SCVs, I don't know what they are doing right here. Maybe for some counter repair, buffering, I don't know. But killing all those Tempests is good stuff. It definitely is good stuff. And the Stalker are fighting the SCVs, okay, instead of the Tempest. That's sad. The base goes down. And the Thor, yes, they are not too bad here at all. They have good upgrades, 3-3. They deal massive damage against the Stalker, look at that. And they also trade quite well against the Zealots, especially with the Widowmines here. Löblix is in a lot of trouble. He does have 12 gateways, but no money left. He just warped in a lot of High Templar. Is warping more Zealots. This base is not the most important, but killing the gateways is good for AT-AT. And he's producing more and more stuff. Maybe AT-AT just killed Löblix here in this game. But it's not over now. Löblix can still come back. He's going into Immortal now. And he got the 3 Robo production, so he can do this. It is fine. Vikings are not good against Immortal. Thor, however, trade really good against Immortal. So the Immortal is not any longer a real hard counter to the Thor. More likely a soft counter, I would say. For its price, of course. Oh, the Zealots, they do have charge. So this is really helpful. But the Thor is so tanky, look at that. Takes almost no damage here. Because they're... Oh! The Zealots don't have weapon attacks. That's why the Stalker are also not that great. Löblix completely skipped the weapon attacks in this game. In order to get the shield upgrades and the air upgrades and the air armor upgrades done. Yeah, that's that. No. No air armor upgrades, oh wow. Just air attack upgrades and the shields. Yeah, this is like... It's so difficult to win this. He does clear this part, however. There's way more army back behind. Lots of Widowmines, some Thor, Vikings, even more Thor. But AT-ATs... income isn't looking that healthy, I have to say. If you look at Löblix's income, it's looking a little bit better. But on the other hand, yeah, new hammer, and there you go, look at that, bam! Just skyrocketing here. Out of control. This is really, really massive. I don't know if Löblix can win this. He's going into a lot of Immortal, some Archons, and that's nice, but his upgrades are not looking good enough. He does realize it now, but it might just be too late. There's a Widowmine, Planetary Fortress, there's a big attack, and the Thor will just shrek this army, completely wreck it. Killing everything, oh wow. Nice connections with the Widowmines as well. And this army is just so out of position. If this base falls now, then it's not looking good at all for Löblix. And here comes the Thor! Oh wow. Interesting choice to kill the pylon. He's losing some Thor in the process. Oh, the Widowmines! Oh wow. Oh, killing quite some worker, not too many. The Thor just might die here. The supply tells the story of this game. Right now, AT-AT is just way... Ah, look at that. Wow. I don't think that Löblix will be able to hold the next wave of attack. I don't think he will be able to hold this at all. Like, this is so much mech power. There we go, the potential last attack of this game. I don't see Löblix winning. Mothership calls out, Photon Overcharge might be used. This High Templar could throw down two storms but just dies. And there's the warp in. But it's not enough. Not at all. This base is toast. And there we go, GG. And ATAT wins game number 2. And here we are, game number 3, between those two guys, on Frost Ladder Edition, spawning in the top left hand side, as the yellow Protoss playing for the Drunken Outlaws, it is Löblix. And his opponent spawning in the top right hand side of Frost Ladder Edition, playing for himself, he won just the last game, as the Blue Terran, it is ATAT. Can he win the series? Or will Löblix be able to pull it back? We just will see right now. Again, a fairly even early scout out of both player. But on a 4-player map, that's totally fine. In my opinion, that's good. Go scout where your opponent is. You wanna know. Yeah, gate, gas. And then try to saturate it slowly out of Löblix, while we have Rex gas for ATAT. But he needs to saturate this. Come on! Two SUVs is not enough! There we go. And here comes the Nexus for Löblix. So interestingly, both player will scout the spawn location of their opponent last. Which is quite funny if you think about it. So there comes the command center any second now. Nice. I'm really curious to see what Löblix and ATAT will play here. In the last game, ATAT went greedy and was able to win with Mag, which was quite nice to watch. On Frost, this map is not a really good Mag map in my opinion. It was in Heart of the Swarm because you could go up to 4 bases fairly easy. You have the watchtowers, the vision, you can reposition. But if it goes into the later stage of the game, cutting this map into 2 pieces is really difficult, I think. Now Reaper goes in. Don't attack the core. No. Ah, does he lose the Reaper? Wow, he loses the Reaper to the Adept because of the probe. And the probe killing an SCV, also delaying the command center from being built. That's some really good damage out of Löblix. Also, oh wow, 600, 700 Overmans. For ATAT, he got completely destroyed so far in this game. He's going with the greedy command center, but he lost the Reaper. He dealt no damage, he took damage himself. This SCV is idle. And Hellions, just imagine two Adepts, a probe and a Mothership core moving across the map. That sounds like a really bad joke. but yeah, this could deal game-ending damage. There is nothing to defend. A bunker is nice, but what do you put inside of a bunker if you don't produce marines, battalions? Not much. Maybe SCVs, but they can't shoot out. Which is interesting. SCVs, I think, they can't attack out of the bunker. So if there would be zealots or circlings attacking, the SCVs can't attack from inside the bunker. They can't. They can't also not repair the bunker from the inside out. It's not possible. Here comes the Adept Shade. Will get cancelled? Maybe? No. So seeking for some damage. Will get one SCV so far. Still no reaction out of AT-AT. Might get a second kill. Ah, there we go. Might get a third kill as well. There, oh, wow. Shouldn't find a fourth one, but ooh, forced the mule as well. And the mule is just about to expire. Uh-oh. That's some wasted minerals. The command center did finish, but back at home, Löblix is going for a huge blink attack, going up to 8 gates, potentially? Yeah, I think so. 2 already so far, 4 more coming, so it's 6 gates for now. Oh, he got a robotics bay. Ah, okay, facility. That makes sense. And Blink Stalker are awesome against Hellions, at least in the current numbers. If there would be 30 to 40 Hellions, then Blink Stalker don't do too well against Hellions. But like now? And the position of the Stalker in the Mothership Core with the pylon is very good for Löblix. It is really good. Going up to some more gates. Yeah, poking in, sees it and is like, nope. I'm out of here. Second factory comes down. I like that. So we just might see Mac here out of AT-AT again. He has a lot of gas, so if he can spend it on tanks and widow mines, maybe he can hold. Maybe he can hold. But how is it looking? There are 9 gateways. Soon. No? Yes, 9. And there's the attack coming. There is no warp prism, however, so warp in will be made back at home instead of at the front, where you normally wanna warp in if you attack as a Protoss. Or in the main base to distract your opponent and force him to split his army. But yeah, we will see. Also, there's no observer, so this Widowmine will get a huge shot. Unless he blinks micros. And this one as well. So let's see what Löblix does. He does go in with the pylon. Okay, so we will have slow warp-ins. Oh no, there's the warp prism. Never mind. Never mind. But yeah, here we go. And blue flame is not helpful against Stalker or Immortal as well. You wanna have some tanks, buddy? Come on, tanks! Tanks and widow mines, they are really good against this kind of army. Oh, so many Stalker are coming. This is a huge Protoss force, and he is ahead in army supply. He does have Blink and a Warp Prism as well. There you see the slow warping, taking 11 seconds. And there we go, widow mine. Nice Blink, not too bad. There's another widow mine. And will he blink away from it? No, not this time, but there's no counter repair on the bunker. The Hellions, yeah, he needs to evacuate this base. And yes, the Widowmine's got some good shots, but this is just way too much. There are 23 Stalker against 11 Hellions and 2 tanks with those 3 Widowmines. I think Löblix is in a phenomenal position. He could expand behind that if he wants to. Ah, War Prison, tanks are shot, the Widowmines! However, we'll have a new charge. Are blinking up there into siege tank fire. That's not the best move. Warp Prism survives. Line them up. But there we go. Aggressive blink, killing everything. Not the best focus fire, but here we go. And he's dealing so much damage. Even if he wouldn't end the game right here, it is massive damage. Oh yeah, this warp and reinforcements have arrived. 2 tanks are not enough. Production not enough, those Immortals finally killing the tanks, and Löblix just broke through AT-AT's defense, and those Widow Mines, last ditch effort to defend, but there is now an observer here as well. All those SCVs die, there we go, GG, and Löblix wins game number 3. So, The next game will be a TVZ. So look forward to that. And here we are. Game number one in this best of three. I just wanna check something shortly. Because I think we are now, if I'm not mistaken, yes, we are now round two, round of eight is this now in this tournament. Awesome. Okay, spawning in the bottom left hand side of New Gettysburg Letter Edition as the Red Circle. It is the good old Burst Command. And he's playing against the Blue Terran, playing for Team Kings. Spawning in the bottom right hand side, it is Nemiator. Going with the gas first here against Zerg as well. Okay. A drone scout coming out for Burst Command, which is okay, you can do this. On this map you shouldn't find yourself against too many cheeses. On the other hand, because this map is quite difficult for Terran, you can be forced to play against some early aggression. That's, yeah, it's, I wouldn't cheese on that map because it's not a good map to cheese on, but because it's a very bad map to macro on as well, you might just want to go for a cheese. I do like the drone scout going into be very annoying. Oh wow, salt level rising. The salt level is rising so much. Oh, denied again. Salt level soon should hit more than 9,000, and there we go. And the salt level lowers it again. Yeah, especially when you get the drone, then you are like justice. Oh yeah. And this Reaper is searching for it. Bam and bam. Nice, this drone is so dead. Speed is on the way, hatch does finish, double queen, no circling so far. And that's strange, because now the Reaper can find some damage, potentially. Can jump up here, throw in a grenade, be annoying, maybe get another drone. Oh yeah, that's so good for the Mediator. If he gets another drone, that would be even better. Oh! What? Wait, what? Oh, that's nice. And he gets another drone. Four drone kills. If he gets out, that would be so good for him. The queen pops out, doesn't quite get it. Awesome Reaper control. That was really good. And behind that, his macro didn't slip too bad. Yes, he forgot about the supply depot, and that's not good. As you can see, he's banking up a lot of SUVs here, queuing up, but it's okay. At least he found himself some damage. Killing four drones, that's good. It feels good, at least. I do like that Burst Command is going with the Overlord speed upgrade. How it's called? Pneumatized Carapace. Pneumatized Carapace, yes, that's that. And Overlord Speed finishes up. Whee! So it looks like Nemiator is going with the 16 Marine Stim Drop. He just needs to produce a lot more SM Marines here in order to hit this timing. And because of his supply block, he might not really get it. But getting this Overlord is really nice. Yes, Burst Command did scout now what's coming and he can prepare. And Burst Command is going in with, is answering this with the Lair Tank. So two base Zerg so far, a Roach Worm, and that's not the worst thing you can do as Zerg. On the other hand, if you stay on two base too long, it will get really difficult for you to get the third base up and running at all. Even setting it up against a Terran can be difficult. And yeah, this timing would be nice, but what's going on here? There we go. He still hits quite a good timing, I would say. It's okay. Yes. Overlord spots it. He could try to kill it, but it's might get away. You never know. Boosting in again. Stim will finish up soon. Stim is a bit late, but there is not much to defend. This drop could deal a lot of damage. There are queens. Oh, you don't want to step off creep. Yeah, there you go. Come on, Heyjo, what are you doing? Ah, he's busy muckering up behind that. And that just gave Burst Command a lot of time for the roaches to finish up. And roaches are dealing quite okay against those marines. Stutter Step is decent. Another Stim. You don't wanna lose the Medivacs! Whoa, so close. The straight was okay. Not the best one. The Reaper did better than those 16 marines. And wow, I would be so scared sitting in that medivac. I would be so scared. Interestingly, Heyjo is still on 2 base. He scans. Doesn't get the creep. Can't fight these roaches here. At least he gets some upgrades for himself. The 1-1 is on the way, as well as the combat shields. The armory is a bit too early, but it's fine. The only thing he's lacking is the command center, which he's getting now. There's an overlord he might wanna kill. And Burst Command, on the other hand, wants to drone up hard as he can afford to, without losing 200 attacks. So that's the difficulty with Zerg. To know when you can drone up and when you need to produce army. And Heyjo is lacking 1 barracks. There should be 5 racks. And there are only 4. So that's a small mistake here as well. Infestation pit for Burst Command coming up. Okay. So that's quite early. But sure, if you can afford it, go for it. And because Heyjo is not doing massive pressure, putting massive pressure onto Burst Command, he sure can go for it. Again, some marines and this time 4 medivacs, but this bridge you can't attack there. So he's loading up, boosting into the main base, and that's a smart move. Because there is not much. If he could kill an evolution chamber, that would be good. A queen even is good. Nice transfuse. Corrosive file does hit, however, and this medivac goes down. Solid defense. So he lost a queen. Yeah, lost a queen for a medivac full of marines, and that's an okay trade. So the creep spread is still looking okay for Burst Command, and Burst Command is going for the Hive Tag right now. Additional barrels are coming out just randomly on the map, but sure, you need the production. Get your barracks, get your SCVs going. Sadly, Heyjo stopped producing SCVs here, and this means his production is just not good enough. That is a little bit sad for him. So eventually Burst Command will just run away with his macro, potentially, and win this game, simply because of his good macro. Also, Burst Command just did peak on 700 APM. Not on average, but he had a peak there. Another drop is spotted by the creep tumor, however. And the reaction is in time here as well. Oh, the corrosive files, when they would get casted, it could be massive. And there we go. Not hitting too much here. Oh, your own units, you don't want to do it like that. So the marines, yes, they find some damage. Wow, the corrosive files are killing so much of your own army. And in the meantime, it would have been nice if this force would have moved into the third base. But that's what this drop is doing now. And Navigator is finding some good damage here. Killing a queen, can now work on the drones. The army is still quite out of position. And here we go. So now, both players are even in terms of work. Oh, the medevac! Ooh, so close. So close. Maybe a queen will die here. Oh, the medevac! Ah, so close. Oh, no, no, no. You can't fight there against Zerg. Not against Roach Ravager. Against Ling Bane, maybe. Maybe. But not against Roach Ravager. One Liberator to get killed by Corrosive Biles. Look at that. that's sad. Your army, Nemiator's army is way too small. Can't fight there. And yes, he killed a lot of drones. And he's ahead in SCVs now, but his army is so small. Like, even though his upgrades are really good. Oh, this medivac is so low again. I would never want to sit in this medivac. Never. And Ultra Discovered it finish up. So when that hits, Nemiator is in a lot of trouble. But maybe he can kill it. That would be the perfect opportunity. Yes, there are two. Oh yeah, he gets it. Oh, that's so nice. Sure, there are two Ultralis coming out, but they won't have the chitinous plating. And without the chitinous plating, Ultralis are no way near as strong as with the upgrade. I still think Nemiator should take a fourth base soon, like ASAP. As that is what he needs. He's doing a good job, however. He is heavily supply capped, yes, his macro is not the best, yes, but... Oh, the queens! Oh, nice position on the queens. But for what problems he is facing, he's doing quite good. Oh, look at how much he queued up in the barracks. So many marauder! Oh, wow. Killing their own creep with the corrosive fire. Nice. But yes. Command center would be handy. Normally as Terran you never want to push across this bridge. Never. So yeah, there you go. Boost around, get another angle, fight somewhere else. That's way better. A way smarter move. This command is doing a good job here with the taken bases. He's up one base all the time, which is good. Finally, Nemiator going for the barracks, command center again. But Burst Command needs some more drones. He wants to go up to 66, maybe 72, I feel like. And fighting off, look how much damage the Ultralisk just took there. One volley. Where's the Ultralisk, Kevin? There we go. Chitinous Plating will finish soon. And those units are so dead. Oh. That hurts. Good stim and scan, killing some creep tumors, that's what you want to do against Zerg. It's a bit scared, and yes, this army looks scary. And it is 2-2, or 2-1 against 2-2. Nice focus fire on the Ultralisk. And now the bio is strong. He could kite for days against this. Potentially. Three more Ultralisks on the way. Burst Command near being maxed out. He has some Corruptor. 11 Queens. That's... Where are the 11 Queens? Most of them are near the main base. So it would be nice to have some Queens at least at the front. And Burst Command here going in with the attack. But moving into his own Corrosive Files. But now not migrating. Ooh, taking so much damage. Nemiator here. Kiting back, oh, into the fourth base, and killing a lot here. Wow, Burst Command should have followed this army, but Nemiator is not getting the base. Not really. Yeah, Burst Command needs to get more units out. He's following it up with more Ultralisks and some more Roaches. Interestingly, it's getting adrenal glands, while he is on 0 melee attack upgrades. That's a bit strange. Also, he didn't go for too many circlings here in this game. Yeah, 36, it's okay. What I do like is he's got the Baling Nest and the Greater Spire, so he's opting to get all the tech now. Really all the tech. Which is good. There's a double drop, got spotted multiple times. First command should react to this, however. Oh, those units are so low. And yeah, Burst Command will react to it. So he finds some damage. Maybe he gets the hatchery. Oh, so close, but that was expensive. Especially because there's a fourth base. A fifth one, which can act as a fourth as well. Burst Command needs to get the gases. Scans again the army. I think Namiator is too heavy on marines. Ah, oh, move command! Okay, moving back here. The Ultralis now have the chitinous plating upgrade, which is so helpful. And there are no Liberator, no Vitamines, no Ghosts, no Tanks, nothing. Only Bio. And I can tell you, normally, only Bio loses against this composition. But plus 3 attack upgrade is really good. Look how much damage those Ultralis take with Focus Fire. So, that's not too bad. How many medivacs are there left? 2! That's not enough. And Namiator lost 15 medivacs in this entire game. That's the thing, if Namiator would have kept those medivacs alive, he would have been able to produce Liberator instead against Ultralisk. Burst Command Supply kept here, interesting. Oh, the Queens are now at the front, transfusing the Ultralisk. And this is where it's getting really difficult. There are not enough medivacs here, the circlings are so fast, you can't really stutter step against this. And Namiator is in full retreat mode, stimming again, but this bio is so low now, I think he can't hold this for long. There's no splash, nothing. Oh, more corrosive vials, hitting nothing here. He tries to hide behind his buildings, which is a smart move. But the corrosive piles getting massive hits here. Namiator dropping below 100 supplies so fast. Wow, Burst Command taking a good fight. GG will play it. And Burst Command wins game number 1. Welcome to game number 2 between those two guys. It's TVC still, this time on Frozen Temple, as we have spawning in the top left hand side of Frozen Temple as the Blue Terran playing for Team Kings. It is Namiator. And he's playing against the Red Sir, currently up one game. Can he win now? It is Burst Command. So Namiator is going for the gas first again, which is very interesting, as you normally don't need to go gas first against Zerg. Like, you really don't need to do that. But you can, if you like to, you can. Hatchery goes down, Drone Scout, and on that map I can understand why you want a Drone Scout. While you don't really need to do it in order to hold a 3 Rex Reaper, it definitely helps if you know it's coming. So with the Drone Scout, he can check, hey, is there something going up or not? And he can be annoying with the drone as well if he feels like blocking the supply depot, or maybe stealing a gas, or just attacking an SCV. All those things are really annoying to handle as Terran, But for now, Burst Command is just scouting around, forcing an SCV to be pulled as well. And yeah, that's totally fine. And behind that, he's getting pool and gas. So that is good as well. Second barracks goes down for Nemiator. So we might see the 16 Marine Medivac again out of Nemiator, and that's okay. That's a good build. He wants to get the finally, there we go, reactor. But where's the supply depot? Come on, Nemiator, you need to get the supply depot ASAP, otherwise you will be supply blocked. Burst Command is going into 10 circlings. Wow, that grenade was really good. I have to say, that was really good. But yeah, going up to so many circlings, like 10? That's quite a lot. Oh, and he gets the Reaper. The Reaper should never die to slowlings. And he gets the SCV as well. That's some good damage here. And yeah, where's the supply depot? He did build one, maybe? Where is it? No. He didn't build a supply depot at all. He just didn't produce units, so he doesn't get supply blocked. Okay. The starport is late as well here. Burst Command? Going with overload speed. That's good. He wants to drone up now. He produced too many circlings. But maybe he can find some damage. Oh yeah, Nemiator muling in the main so far, so mules can't get killed here. Only one or two SCVs will die, but still that's some damage you find. And that's not too bad. Oh, the supply depot is lowered. But yeah, you don't go up there against that many marines. If Burst Command would have committed to more circlings, like that's the thing, he's going into lair tech without heavily droning up, just now starting all the drones. So either you go with a link flood and commit, or you go into tech or expand or macro. And he does all of that at the same time. You see, here's the baneling nest coming out right now, and he's on two base, so whatever he wants to have, the baneling nest is not necessarily needed in order to defend long enough to be able to use the two base tech, like Nidus, Mutalisk, Roaches, whatever. But we will see. Engineering bay coming down, okay. The scan, oh, that's a nice scan. Sees the bailing nest, sees the lair finishing up. If only he would know that there's no third base, he would know, okay. That is really strange. For those marines, yeah, it is risky without the medivacs, but with the medivacs it is okay. As long as there are no mutalisks out of the map, it is completely okay. Burst Command doesn't have much to defend here at all. It looks like he's freestyling quite a bit. Yes, he's morphing banelings, but the main base and the natural are not connected. And yeah, this drop from the Nemiator is going in. There are Liberator coming out as well. And how is Burst Command supposed to defend this? Without any units. The first queen goes down, the second queen goes down. Good positioning on the marines, nice stim here. The banelings are coming in. Might get focus fired here, really nicely done. The baneling nest might fall as well. And then there's nothing to defend. All those drones get slaughtered. Wow! The circlings are coming in, the marines are heavily overstimmed. At least some of them, but he holds strong for now. More marines coming across the map. The queens finally matching here, meeting with the army. But is it enough? Can he defend? Oh, barely. He can defend, but oh yeah, more marines. Double liberator. It's not looking good for Burst Command. Locking down the ramp is a really smart move. The queens die. The circlings go down there, but that's looking really bad. GG, well played! And Nemiator does win game number 2. And here we have it, guys. Match ball. Game number 3. In this best of 3. Who would have thought of that? Okay, Apotheosis led edition, a very long map. And we have spawning in the top left hand side. As the red circ, it is Breast Command. And he's playing against the blue Terran, playing for Team Kings. Spawning in the bottom right hand side of Apotheosis, it is Nemiator. Who went for the gas first again? He likes his gas first. He really does like his the gas first build. First command opening up with the hatch pool gas. Standard stuff. Not taking the natural at the gold base. That is okay. There's the pool, finally. So saturating the gas, getting the speed, potentially getting the overlord speed as well. And Nemiator asking if he takes the gold base. I don't think Burst Command will tell you. Of course, he says. I mean, the tournament life of Burst Command is on the line here. So he wants to get further, he wanted to win. And that definitely means, yeah, sure, take any advantage you can get, even if it means you need to lie. And in StarCraft 2 especially, you try to lie to your opponent with your builds, with your actions, you try to fool him, to outplay him, to make him think you're going for something which you aren't, so that he misreads your actions and prepares for wrong things which are not coming. And if you manage to do that, you will get a nice edge in the game. The Reaper, however, of Nemiator will definitely confirm that this was not the case. It should. It should. It doesn't. Wow. But he should know that there's no creep, so if he pays attention to the missing of creep, that's fine. Good micro on the Reaper, but might lose it here to the Queen. Oh, so close, gets away. Wow. Yeah, slightly miss microed the Queen. Did result in the Reaper to survive. That's unfortunate for Burst Command. But okay, better for Nemiator, of course. And he's going in again. Just scouting around, maybe throw in a KDA charge and totally be fine. We will see. Yeah, there he goes. Yep. Maybe he gets a drone. Yes, gets a drone. Okay. I don't think it is worth to sacrifice your Reaper now, because you wanna know, is it gonna be the lair tag again? Is he gonna be taken third base? And on a map like that, which is so long, where it takes a really long time to get units across the map, having a Reaper already there is really good. But okay. So Nemiator again with the 60 Marine Medivac timing. And it's a good build. It's solid, it's strong. The only thing Nemiator isn't doing so far is producing constant SCVs. And look at that, the base for Burst Command is so late, the third one. It is so late. But it looks like Burst Command just wants to feel safe, he wants to play it safe. And that's totally fine. It's totally fine. So there are the medivacs and 14 marines. I don't think it is smart to wait for the next Marines. If you have 14, then just go with 14. If you have 12, go with 12. It is important to hit the timing, and waiting for the Marines will just result in you not hitting that timing. So now your drop will be like 20 seconds later, and it will hit late already on this map because it is so big, so long. But maybe you find some damage. At least you got the double eBay. That's good. And for burst command we see roaches again. So he wants to go with the roaches. He produces some circlings. Yes. But he also gets the upgrade for the roaches. Double drop. Didn't confirm the third base. And he could kill it. There is not much to defend at all. So this drop could deal so much damage. He goes in right now. Let's see. There are enough Marines to kill all this army. Ah, he stims in again. Now those units are quite injured. Oh, he's pulling back. He definitely could have killed all those four queens and potentially dealt a lot of damage. At least he forced 14 roaches out of burst command. And that's good. So that means those are 14 drones not being made right now. Gets another overlord kill. The first one, okay. So that's nice, supply blocking burst command as well. The only thing is he's going up to 8 barracks before the third base again. And I consider that being a mistake. Liberator in a very good position. Good stim and move in, but there are so many roaches. Can he take a good fight? If he could kill the queens, that would be nice. But it's not gonna happen here. Oh, nice. Liberator gets a kill. Needs to unsiege, but that was too late. Worker-wise, it's looking good for Nemeator, however. And upgrade-wise, I would say as well. Yeah, it's 1-1 Zoon against 0-0. There are no evil chambers, just now a Hydralis then coming up. Oh, wow. And a big drop into the main base again. Burst command with the creep spread in the main. I do like that. Is he gonna kill the Roach one? He could. No. He goes in, fights into a concave. Marines against Roaches, not the best thing to do. Command center goes up behind that for an Nemeator, which is good, but he needs to pull back and might just lose a medivac! Ooh, that's so close. Ooh. So, the third base is just now getting saturated. It's not the best, but it's okay. Yeah, I think Burst Command needs a little bit work on his decision making when to drone up. If he would have drone up and defended at the same time, he would be way more ahead. However, he's opting for the hive tag, and that is helpful. If you can go up to hive tag, that is really good. The Liberator are nice. Look at that, you could park the Liberator on top of this platform, so you don't see it, because there's no overlord to spot it. Now the Overseer are there, okay. But Nemeator is doing some pressure, even though he's not committing, he's putting some pressure on burst command, which currently is going to produce some circlings. There is no bailing list. No, Lurker. Lurker is the way to go for burst command here. Nemeator finally taking space. He could fire up 2-2 if he would have the gas for it, which he's just now taken. Oh yeah. That's very interesting. So now that the rocks are broken down, it will be more difficult for Nemeator to go in and deal damage. But still, he's putting on some pressure. Just sitting outside of the base is a threat. Burst Command needs to react to. Oh, nice position on the queens. And it did pay off. They get the Liberator. So scan again. Should maybe kill the creep tumor. Forces another scan there. That's really unlucky. Okay. Yeah, Nemiator not doing a bad job here at all. His macro is looking okay now, but it's a very slow game currently. I would like Burst Command to take a fourth base eventually. At least he's getting Lurker. Going for the Spire, so with the high finishing up soon, getting Spire, maybe we might see Broodlords. And there we go with the fourth base. That's nice. What are the upgrades? Oh, there are no upgrades for Burst Command. If Nemiator wins this game, it could be because of this, of the difference in upgrades. However, you don't wanna move into the Lurker right here. Funnel through that hole would be a bad choice. Sadly, the Liberator don't have the Liberator range upgrade. If they would have the, how it's called, ballistics, advanced ballistics, that would be so useful against the Lurker. Yeah, it looks like Nemiator wants to fight here. Oh, killing both Liberator was good. He didn't lose any Lurker there. That was a good and small engagement for Burst Command. All those units are injured as well. And there are still queens somewhat in position to prevent any drop. Ultralisk Cavern is on the way as well now, as well as some Corruptor. Oh, don't go in there! 2 seconds, if Nemiator would have stayed in there, 2 seconds more, that would have been so bad. But he pulled back in time. Eventually he wants to get another base. He's oversaturated everywhere, which is not really good for him. And oh, those Lurker are dealing a good job. Against Lurker normally you want to have some Liberator can work, but tanks are better in general because they have more range. That's good! Getting into killing 2 Lurker, but also taking a lot of damage. Yes, I do think Burst Command needs more gas in order to get the Ultralisk Cavern. And he's still not using the Evo Chamber. There are no upgrades at all. And soon he will fight 0-0 against 3-2, potentially 3-3 in the late game. And it could be so bad. You need upgrades. Yes, Splash, Zerg and Ultralisk are good, but without upgrades, that's really difficult. Another Lurker almost falling. Okay. Close one. And Nemiator is going around now. Good snipe on that one. Oh, don't! Ooh! Huge hits on your own units. And there are almost just Marines here. But they will be able to kill a lot. All the Corruptor going down. All the Ravager going down. That's, yeah, you kite away from the Lurker and you're fine. Oh, this looks so devastating for Burst Command. How are you supposed to win now without any upgrades? The Ultralisks are late, and even if they would come out, I don't think it would matter too much. The fourth base under pressure as well. And you can't win against that many Marines with Medivacs if you don't have any upgrades. The Queen's attacking the rocks! No! Ooh, that's also not one. Yeah, it doesn't matter. Too many Marines. That's just GG. It has to be. The Ultralisks are popping out right now. The Lurker get focused down here. The High Falls. And yeah, Burst Command drops 100 supply. I mean, look at the focus fire. Marines are so good with upgrades against non-upgraded Zerg units. GG well played. And Nemeator wins this game and advances to the semifinals. What's going on here? Okay. And here we are in the next series, still round of 8. Nice. Okay. Spawning on New Gettysburg. In the bottom left position, playing for himself as the Green Terran, it is FIFO. And he's playing against the Teal Terran, spawning in the bottom right hand position, it is Head Bagel. Is it Beagle or Bagel? I think it's Bagel. It should be called Bagel. Bagel? It should be Bagel. Very interesting opening. He's skipping a lot of SCV production in order to get the full wall off ASAP to prevent scouting. It is a huge commitment in my opinion, but maybe it will pay off. Who knows? He's going... Wow. And FIFO is going double gas here, so we might see a factory soon. However, those gases are just... It was Rex first, I guess. So... FIFO will not be able to get a factory in time when the Rex finishes. You can get the Marine and the Orbital Command and the Supply Depot, that's fine. But very interesting opening out of both players so far in this game. This is really interesting. Really interesting gameplay. A tech lab for Head Bagel, okay. And a factory for FIFO. And so far both Terrans are on one base. There is a base coming down here, and it looks like with the position of this base, Head Bagel wants to go for the island base. And that could be so nice. FIFO does not know what's going on because of the early block. So he has to assume, yes, it is one base attack. Some one base pressure, one base expand. So one base pressure into expand, I mean. But it looks like for Head Bagel, no. He's just walling off here, going with an early command center, fairly early, I have to say. And then that's some kind of eco trees, which can work as well. However, FIFO is going for a real one base build. And if Head Bagel can't defend this, then that's bad, especially in TVP, where most of the time you have a Liberator, a Banji, or a Drop moving across the map. Taking an island base is, early on, I don't know, difficult to say at least. It will get spotted most of the time, so I don't think that that is viable. But we will see what happens here in this game. Stim on the way for Head Bagel, and he takes this base. Loading up one SCV. Whee. And here they are, taking another base. Weep, weep, weep. I never saw this. Throwing down a mule here, even. Sure, why not? Why the hell not? And it lines up perfectly with the command center. So nice. And FIFO is going with tanks, marines, and a Viking. Okay. So maybe he won't be able to spot this that early. But there is not much back at home for Headbagel to defend. He doesn't have tanks, or Vikings, or Liberator, or Benji, or Raven himself. So far, only Marines with Stimsoon, which is not the best tank. But we will see. We will see. FIFO is moving out now. And taking a base, I assume. He's not gonna attack. So, even though Headbagel was in major danger, in my opinion, because of how FIFO approaches this matchup, he is fine. He's completely fine. And he did build a planetary here. Okay. That's really interesting. Just imagine having 4 to 5 tanks here. And if something wants to move across the bridge, it just gets completely destroyed. That would be so nice to see. Not gonna happen for now, but who knows? You know? Who knows? Headbagel is moving out with his marines here. Not gonna kill the city, or is he? Yes, he should. No, he's not. Yes, he is. There we go. Okay. I really thought because of the planetary we would see Mac and Catrock style Raven. But that's not the case here in this game so far. And FIFO is not taking it easy as well. I don't know. This TVT is really, really strange. Unorthodox, you could say. You should soon see Headbagel transferring some SCVs, like 10 or 12, towards this base. And potentially he will grab his third base soon as well. I don't know why he goes so heavy into Widowmines. Tanks are obviously way better. But he has his own style, and if it works, sure, why not? Maybe this is the new next level TVT we see right here, the new meta game. So finally FIFO is getting Stim himself, and he's killing those unbuildable bricks. He gets concussive shells while having only one marauder now. No wait, no marauder. No marauder. Maybe he should have gone for the combat shields first. There we go, loading in all those SCVs and boosting towards that base. I like it. It's a quite safe base. If you get the turrets up, then it's very hard to drop here, unless you have a Raven with PDD. And even if you then drop, there's a planetary fortress. Oh, now he finds it. FIFO finding the space. Okay. Oh, this Viking is so trapped. Oh, you need to micro harder. Oh. This Viking likes to move it. Definitely. He will never stop. So FIFO is taking another base. Getting the plus one attack upgrade, which is good. If he gets combat shields after that Stim, that would be nice as well. Turret finishes up, kills the moving Viking. But Headbagel so far on two base, while FIFO is going into a third one. And this... more starports. Where are they? Right here. Will we see Sky Terran? Potentially. Tech Lab! Okay, so he is going into double tech lab. Could be for Benji, but I assume it will be Raven. And if he gets the third base and takes the gases, then Master Raven can be so damn strong. He's saturated the gases now, which is good. FIFO ever taking a fourth base. Wow. Okay. Combat shields. That is good, and there's the third base for Headbagel. A very defensive TVT so far. really defensive. This guy's guys are not saturated here. Okay, another factory, that's good. Eventually FIFA wants to go up to more barracks, like 8 on 3 base, and if you are on 4 base you can go up to 12 if you are maxed out for the extra production. You can do it. If you're not constantly trading, then adding more production is worth it, in my opinion. Hellbagel, setting up a minefield, which is not too bad, and some tanks. So far he didn't use the starports and the tech labs at all, which is a little bit strange. But he's getting double command center like FIFO as well. And there's the first real drop. Neither player so far took the watchtower, and we are now hitting the 10-minute mark. Interestingly, if you're a really good player, you can be maxed out at the 10-minute mark. So, as you can see, for both of those players, there's a lot of room to improve, which is awesome. I like it. I like it a lot. They can improve so much up until Master and GM. So much room to improve. This drop could deal some damage. Might get this planet. Oh no, not versus a planetary. If he would go in right now, maybe. Will he get it? He could. The turret, however, will. Oh, not finish up. Wow. He cancels the planetary. Why would you do that? The planetary would have helped so much in this situation, but he's just losing the command center. Oh wow. Oh wow. Wow. That should have never happened, to be honest. At all. So he's getting another command center now. Okay. This medivac might just barely fly into range of the Vikings. Yes. And should get taken out. No, he reacts in time. Boosts away, saves the medivac for now. That is really nice. And he took the space. Should get the gases. He's going heavy into Liberator. Okay. Like, heavy into Liberator. But then I'm not sure what is with the double tech lab. One tech lab would have been enough. And you want to get the upgrade, the Liberator range upgrade, the ballistics, the advanced ballistics it's called. Missile turrets, take the gases, take the gases! Still no combat shields for Headbagel. Wow, that scan. Ah, he sees it with the sensor turret, with the watchtower. Okay. I was wondering, how does he know? But that explains it a lot. This drop is still there, opting for some damage, or just waiting. For now. And I don't know if FIFO can go in there. There's a double Widowmine drop. Double Widowmine, I mean. Dealing quite some damage, but not the best hits. And now you need to decide, do you stim in or not? And he does stim in, kills his own tank. And this fight is going not too bad. Double planetary here as well, wow. So the Liberator, I don't know if they are so good in this situation against Bio. The medevac joins this army now. This Viking dealing some damage gets killed. Oh wow, wow, the Liberator dealing so much damage to the medivacs. All of them are potentially going down. But the tank is helping out here a lot to win this fight. At least the trade wasn't too bad for FIFO here. But gas wise, well, it's still even. Both players could win this game, and the supply is a little bit misleading here. I would still say, yeah, Heyjo has the potential to win this. But I'm not sure if he should move out across the map now, in this situation. Could be risky. Could be very risky. Liberator are not that good against large amount of bio units. It's like, Liberator are good against tanks, yes, and cyclones, maybe, if they get in range, but against marines like that? That's not really good. And Headbanger will lose this fight heavily. Look at that, all those expensive Liberator get killed. And now FIFO took a really favorable engagement, a really good fight. And now he's ahead, now he's really ahead. The upgrades are also looking good for FIFO here in this game. Ooh, nice Vikings. And boosting into turrets. Just throwing away all your army. And dropping below 100 supply. Headbagel has a lot of minerals and gas in his bank. But still, he doesn't have the production. He is on 2 barracks, 1 factory and 3 starports, which is not enough. And those Liberator like to move it as well. Look at that. Wow. Air blockers! Damn you! Finally he's going into more barracks. I don't like the position of the ranks, but at least he's getting more production. But FIFO is near being maxed out. And he is preparing a huge attack. And there is not much to defend. There are still no combat shields for Headbanger's Marines. So, one tank, one planetary, you could try to bust it. Especially when those units move away and open a spot. And there we go, big attack onto the planetary. Counter repair comes in. Will it be enough? It looks like barely not. So the planetary falls, the tanks are dealing massive damage. Wow, look at that. A bit unfortunate with the unsiege, so Headbagel can hold this for now, but he lost a planetary and all he can do is lift this orbital command somewhere else. He's only on one orbital command. And FIFO behind, yeah, nicely taking additional bases, solid macro, good upgrades, it's looking good for him. Really looking good for him. So he's up 50 supply. He could move across the map and deal good damage, which he just might do now. Oh, that's not the perfect time to unsiege. Definitely not. FIFO moving in. And there are no Vikings. They are not dealing too good here, but the upgrades are helping out a lot. And is FIFO winning this? He gets the tank, but loses the fight bio versus bio. So the game is still running. And Headbagel has still the chance, if only he would get... Now he got some upgrades, that's good, at least plus 2 armor upgrades, but he needs... I don't know, maybe better upgrades, the combat shields would be so nice. He's just now getting another base. The island base is heavily oversaturated, as well as the natural. Yeah. And FIFO is looking healthy, 3000 income. Mineral income per minute. That's looking really nice. And he just might attack soon again. He has better upgrades, like he's 2 upgrades up ahead. There we go, evac stuff. It's not looking too good for Headbagel here. FIFO might just be able to close it out soon. Good tank position. The Widowmines also helping out a lot. Ooh, wow, the splash is real. Stim as well. FIFO taking a really good fight here. Finally being able to break through, as it looks like. Doubling the supply of Head Bagel. There's no planetary here this time. This tank's helping out a little bit, but FIFO's just going around it, seeking for damage elsewhere, and he finds damage. He goes in, kills the tanks. He's on top of the Terran production now. Forces the liftoff and taking out a lot of production facilities. The tank might die here as well, the planetary. Even if it finishes, this is so much bio, it should just be enough to just kill it. There we go, planetary gets denied. More units marching across the map. And FIFO eventually manages to take out Head Bagel's defenses. Scans again. That's the last fortification Head Bagel has. If we don't count that one. Yeah. I think FIFO has this game. There's almost no mining going on for Head Bagel. He tries to move out, kills something, loses another factory. G! And FIFO wins game number one. Oopsie, that's wrong. There we are. Game number two in this best of three. As we have spawning in the top left hand side of Frozen Temple. As the Teal Terran, it is Head Bagel. And he's playing against the Green Terran spawning in the bottom right hand side of Frozen Temple. Playing for himself, it is FIFO. So Head Bagel going for the really early refinery with the super early supply depot just to block again. Very interesting move. And FIFO will scout this with the SCV he got. I think potentially if he would open up 3 Rex Reaper he could totally crush this, but there's a second barracks coming out of Head Bagel. So we will see what those players decide to do. I think out of Head Bagel we will see the same style again. Only that this time there is no island base he can take. And FIFO going with the Marine might go for safety tanks here in this game as well. Like he did last game, and the safety Vikings, just to feel good. So that's fine. Head Bagel going in with the Reaper this time. Okay, going for the Reaper, and FIFO with the factory. So, double Reaper for Head Bagel. Okay, he's switching it up. Just a little bit, and maybe it will pay off as he's continuing to produce Reaper. And yeah, Reaper can work quite well in TVT nowadays, so maybe. But he's not moving across the map, he's playing it safe, which is totally fine. And FIFO as well, only going Marines for now, one at a time. Factory finishes up. Going for the tech lab here. Head Bagel with the 3 Reaper now moving across the map and going into double reactor. Okay. Maybe for even more Reaper, but potentially more Marines. Oh, He's not moving up. With good micro, he could kill all those SL Marines. And he takes a very good angle here, killing one of those, killing another one, and going for the SEVs here. Nice grenades, killing quite a lot of stuff, and dealing good damage, but there's the big boy, the tank. You need to evac ASAP. Ooh. Only one Reaper gets out alive. And yeah, they didn't pay off too well here. Only killed one SCV. And three Marines, of course, but that's neglectable damage, I would say. Oh, this SCV, very unlucky, will get killed. And FIFO going into the command center and the starport here. And for Headbagel, the command center finishes up right now. So with the eBay being that early, I assume he will get a planetary fortress at his natural. Potentially. But for now he doesn't have any minerals left at all. He's loading up the SCVs to fly down there. That is really interesting. He likes the load-in command. He definitely likes it. I do think that moving the SCVs just manually down there to the mineral line would be faster, but it's okay. Let them fly. There we go. And morph it. Ah! Orbital command. Nice. So no planetary this time there. And I think this will pay off. The double mule is so important. It really is. Yeah, FIFO playing it safe again. Stim should be finished already for him? No! Oh wow! So he's prioritizing combat shields in this game over Stim. And I don't know. Normally you wanna have Stim. It takes the longest. And with Stim you just can move out on the map. Without Stim, all the attacks, all the drops you want to do as a Terran are just less strong, so yeah, that's I don't know, it's hard to find damage without Stim, and still I think Stim Marines do kill Combat Shields Marines in an even fight, but I might be wrong here. So yeah, FIFO is taking it very defensively, as well as Headbagel. Worker-wise, FIFO is a little bit ahead. Army-wise, it's looking even. The upgrades are so far okay for both players as well. Interestingly, we do see Cloak Banshee at the second starport. So Headbagel likes to go into Sky Terran. The only question is, will this work in a TVT? Does Sky Terran work in a TVT or not? And I'm really not sure about this, to be honest. I'm really not sure if Sky Terran can work or not in TVT. Both player macroing up quite nicely and taking it very slow. FIFO could play a little bit more aggressively in this game as he is up one game so far. But he doesn't want to risk everything here or anything, so it's fine. Some idle SCVs here, A lot of idle SUVs, to be honest. Oh yeah, a lot of idle SUVs. Finding so many idle SUVs. What's going on? They all should mine. The third command center goes up for Herd Bagel. And this time he tries out the Raven for his Sky Terran composition. And the Raven can be really strong, especially when you get the upgrades, like the Shrapnel upgrades and the Corvid Reactor, I think it's called, for the more starting energy. That is really helpful. So let's see. Plus 2 attack for FIFO. Another scan. Wait, why would... Okay. He scanned for the one SCV. That's very interesting. Oh, this drop could deal massive damage, but there is a huge force waiting. Even though Stim is not finished now, for now, you can't drop into that, but you can chip away a lot of units. And that's what he's doing. So, relocating the tanks. Oh, you need to drop! Ooh, the Raven come down. They get killed without doing anything. That is really expensive. But the drop gets cleared quite okay. Move command, no attack command, but he just has enough units, or has he? No. Not the case here. But because of the turret placement and the tank, he can't really drop on top of that. He tries to find another opening, which currently is difficult for him to do so. At least he's taking another base and more production, which is exactly what he needs to do. He does miss the orbital command. Landing at the third base. And he's taking a fight here, killing quite a lot of SCVs, but no, that was okay. It was really okay. He's now up 20 SCVs, which is really good. His base, however, is a little bit late. So maybe Herd Bagel can macro out of it and be fine. Who knows? Who knows? Ooh, FIFO taking a fourth base. A little bit, it's not really a ninja base, but normally you get this base as your fourth base in most cases, so you could consider it a ninja base. Yeah, and this time Herd Bagel got the combat shields, that's so good. That really helps out a lot. But FIFO seems to have the better production so far in this game. He's producing more at a time, he's ahead. In army supply, worker supply, upgrades, I think, as well. Yes, so yeah, that's he's ahead. I assume he will max out and then move across the map. Ooh, he got a planetary at the third base. That's interesting. Okay, here we have a big fight upcoming. The army for Herd Bagel seems to be a little bit stronger, but the late stim and the upgrades, will it still be enough? It looks like the answer is yes. Just barely. Okay. So Herd Bagel takes a really good fight, might be able to just kill this command center with the Marauder if Thief isn't lifting in time. But he does, so that's good. But will he be able to defend? Fifu has more army supply, but it's in Vikings and Medivac, so not the best thing here. However, with the tanks he should be fine. Oh, don't lose the command center. He shouldn't lose it. He might just get some medivac kills, which is good. And Heldbagel soon should take a fourth base himself as well. Oh, nice snipe there on that medivac. That was really good. Moving into the tanks, but there's nothing to buffer. So one might just get killed. The second one potentially as well. The third one not sieged now. Will get killed before it can siege. This part of the army not fighting at all. But it's looking okay. Fifu is up 2 upgrades now. He's up 70 supply. I think he soon should be able to move across the map and kill Heyjo. Heyjo has a lot of... Oh yeah. But I think he forgot to put the barracks into the control group. He's not constantly producing while he's attacking. Otherwise he would have a really good chance here to win this game. But as it's now looking, it's not that good. Not that good at all. So yeah, FIFO with the fourth base, which is really helpful, transferring some SCVs. That is nice. And looks like FIFO moving across the map. He's still up 70 supply, so maybe he can win. There are no tanks, no medivacs. This is not looking good for Heyjo at all. Even though all the Vikings there into the turret, that's not good, but with the upgrades as well, FIFO will just overwhelm Heyjo here and win massively this fight. And potentially the game. There's one tank left. The turrets are dealing massive amount of damage. And the tank as well, but gets killed. This tank is in an awesome position as well, but can't quite protect the third base, which will get killed here. There is no base here at the fourth base location. So all those SCVs have nothing to hide there. I think FIFO got this. He might just be able to win this 2-0. Supply depot is lowered, so those units out of FIFO can go in. Sniping the tank. Now he's on top of the production. You can lift. Yes, Heyjo, but you can't escape. You have not enough stuff there. There we go. G. And FIFO wins game number 2. Really nicely done. Okay guys, we are now entering the last series I'm gonna cast today. It is a TVR, so Terran versus Random. No, it's not, it's a PVR. PVR, I'm sorry, my bad. As we have, let's go into this game. Best of 3 spawning on New Gettysburg. as the yellow Protoss, and the bottom left hand side playing for the Drunken Outlaws, it is Liblate. Going with the early scout as well. And he's playing against the blue, this time Zerg, playing for himself, spawning in the bottom right position, it is Waffles. So let's see. Let's see, he goes in and scouts quite a bit. At least now he knows he's playing against Zerg. So that is nice. It is really nice. Parks the probe outside. And let's see what Liblix is doing here in this PVZ. I think it's the first PVZ we had today. Yeah, I think so. I think that's the case. Ooh, and Waffles just might go. Ah, he did search for the probe. That is very interesting. That is really very interesting. Ooh, nice pylon block here. And the probe survives. Cybernetic score going down for Liblix. And yeah, I'm really interested to see how good Waffles' PVC is. How good are his Zerg skills? Can he creep spread? Can he... Yeah, what can he do? What will he do? Going into a fairly quick robotics facility, but it's okay. I would consider this being a normal timing. The queen not injecting the hatchery, but this drone is scouting quite a lot and should get out safely. Oh yeah, nice. Wow, the salad not killing the drone. Two Zerglings attacking this pylon. So there are some small mistakes coming out of Waffles here so far, but it's okay. And we do see a RAWR. And this RAWR is really early, I think. So let's see what's gonna happen here. Hatchery ready to be injected again. There we go. Pylon gets killed, so now Waffles could take another base. The Overlord spread is not looking too bad either. He just sees the Twilight Council. Oh wow, that's lucky. That is lucky. If he clicked, he also would know that there is a robotics facility. And then he can play around this. So he might know, okay, Twilight Council could be blinked, but most likely a dead play with a warp prison. Could see a gateway explosion soon, potentially, but maybe not, we will see. So here's the observer moving across the map, and the third hatchery finally coming down, as well as the lair tech. Okay, okay. Forge for Liblix. And one gateway. I still think we will see some adept attack. Especially with the forge. That's normally for plus one. Against Terran. Against Zerg you could also go with the armor. You do 22 damage against light units. Zergling have 35, so that's totally fine. And drones can get two-shotted as well. But we will see. There's the resonating glaze. Double evil chamber for Waffles. Some roaches were made as well. And yeah, armor upgrade. Ho ho ho! I have some clue about PVC. Awesome. Oh, but he wants to take up a nexus. Okay, so no gateway explosion for now. No two base attack. Which is okay. He adds three more gates. Four more gates. Oh wow. So There is the gateway explosion, however. Very interesting, very interesting style. Will Waffles be able to hold this, if that's the commitment? I mean, we might still see a Nexus going up here soon. He's pulling another probe, even though he has one there. That's funny. Okay. But still, he will use those gateways for something. So far, there are Immortal being produced, no Warp Prison. So, who knows? Waffles might eventually saturate those gases. But for now, he's just producing upgrades, roaches, and he's fine. There's a Warp Prism. So with the Warp Prism, either we see a huge attack, or we see just some harassment, or some multi-prong attack. Could happen as well. The armor upgrade will finish soon. Twilight Council already done, so yeah, we might see plus 2 armor firing up soon. And I think Löblix could transition into something else. He's adding 2 more gates, going up to 9 in total. He's adding some cannons and Waffles. Yes, his creep spread looks okay. But yeah, he needs a macro hedge, which he's getting with the fourth base, which is scouted. Löblix scouted that one. And Löblix is producing probes, so... Ah, yeah. Ooh, burrow and tunneling claws. That is really nice. And I think he got the roach speed already. Yes, he does. He also got overlord speed, which is really helpful. Look how fast Overseer is. Whee! Scouts the robotics bay, scouts everything. Second forge, which is really good. Photon overcharge. Not quite enough to kill this Overseer. And it gets away. Or does it? There's a changeling. Gets shot down. I still think drone-wise it's not looking good for Waffles. See, his injects are not that good. He needs a macro hedge. He needs to produce units. 3k overmints is way too much for not being over 100 supply. Even if you are 150, you don't want to have that many resources. There we go with the drones, but Löblix is moving out. It's spotted by the circling, which is really good for him, but can he defend? Can Waffles defend this attack? There are 9 gates, if I'm not mistaken, which is a lot. There's no blink, however. Oh, there we see Hydralisk. We don't have the Lurker then currently, which would help so much in this situation. We do see Disruptor and another robotics facility. I like that move. And yeah, Löblix now warping in something, but he's short on gas and soon supply cap. That's sad. Yeah, he might try to... Oh, the changeling spotted it. Well, why would you cancel the weapon? No. But yeah, can he take this fight? The Immortal are not fighting. The force fields are decent. However, this might just be too much Zerg. Not the best micro. No Guardian Shield. Yeah, that fight wasn't too good. You need Guardian Shields. You need to use Guardian Shield. And he cancelled the warp in. Lots of adepts coming in right now. But Hydralisk, they have a very high DPS. Look at that. It's like 26 damage almost every second. That's really good. It's really good DPS. Löblix going for the 4th base finally. Using the double forge very well. 5 pylons, 6 pylons in total. Sure, why not? Going up to 8 pylons now. He does definitely gonna get rid of the supply cap. And yeah, the injects for Waffles are not looking that good. Shades in, cancels the shade. That's a smart decision in my opinion. And now Waffles is going up to Hive Tech. And if he does go up to Hive Tech, then things are getting a lot more difficult for Liblix, I guess. Broodlords are strong and Ultralis are strong as well. But we do have double disruptor play here. Oh, those roaches. We move unseen. Ah, Observer does survive. And there's a War Prism. Does survive as well so far. Ooh. Okay, Liblix going in here to kill the fifth base. But being spread out like that, oh, the corrosive piles do hit. And he's taking not a really good engagement here. Finally, with the Guardian Shield, but it's not enough. Look at the Hydrolis, they deal so much damage. The Roaches are coming back, but that fight went just so good for Waffles. Hive does finish. He goes in with 14 more Hydrolis and 12 more Circlings. That's good. Lurkadan will finish up soon. Still, the Warp Prism is idle. However, we have 1-1 upgrades against 2-2. Oh no, we will have 2-2 soon against 2-2, so never mind. So it all comes down to the disruptor hits, and there are 5 disruptor. They could deal massive damage. Potentially. If they get it. But this Nexus is so dead, look at the damage. There comes one disruptor shot, massive hit, wow! And even more, very good hits. Don't lose the disruptor though, but now Liblix can take this fight quite convincingly. Loses 2 disruptor unnecessarily, which is sad, but those hits were massive. Aggressive blink forward into Hydrolis, okay, can work. And yet still, this warp prison is idle. Oh yeah! Idle prison. Ah, Ultralis Cavern. Finally using the Hive Tech Waffles here. Very nice. And Liblix still going heavily into the disruptor play, which is nice, but he shouldn't do too many disruptor. I think 6 should be enough. So if he would switch it up now with Colossus, in my opinion that would be a very good move. Or maybe go into Stargate. If you can't get up your 4th base, which you should do ASAP now and saturate and take the gases, go into Stargate. Stargate Tempest could be really helpful, especially against Lurker, but also against Broodlords. They are not that bad if you have something to buffer. Like, there are sadly no Immortal left. And no sentries as well. And yes, sentries are not good against Ultralis, but they definitely help against the Circlings. But if you move in like that and wow! Like 1/3 of all the Circlings he just morphed were killed in this small engagement. And Liblix is moving out now. He wants to kill this base again. And he might just get it. This time no force shields, but disruptor hits. And they might find massive hits. So far it's not looking too good, but that one was a very good one. If you can't find more, the Lurker burrowing, and all those disruptors are dying. But yeah, Liblix stays strong and will be able to kill this hatchery. Not bad, not bad at all. It is however sad that he lost the disruptor. If only would have had the warp prism with his army to warp in now. That would be so helpful. Now he's warping in at home, yes. And this army, he can't evacuate now. He gets not the best hits. There's no mothership core with this army, so no recall. And all those units just die. And those disruptors take a long time. They are expensive. So I would say Waffles now is ahead in this game. And his creep spread is looking good as well. He covers a lot of this map in creep, so he knows what's going on. Oh wow, so many cannons. Emergency pylons. But can he hold this attack? That is the big question. Pew pew! I don't think that those two disruptor will make a huge difference here. The first one completely misses. The second one... Where's the second one? Might get a nice hit. Nope, misses completely as well. The fourth nexus will fall. And then we have Blinkstalker and Zealot against Speedlings, Hydrolisk, Lurker and Ultralisk. And I can tell you, normally the Zerg should win this fight. But is Waffles gonna commit here? Will he commit? Or not? Ah, there we go. Sentry is very useful. Archons would have been nice as well for Löblegs. The problem with the sentries is Ultralis can stomp the force field. And Waffles is going into double spire behind that. Löblegs, however, going finally for the DT shrine. If he can snipe the overseer and he has Blinkstalker. The purpose of Blinkstalker is normally to snipe key units, and that would be such a key unit. If he could get it, that would be awesome, but losing 13 Stalker potentially for one Overseer, is it worth it? The Dark Templar Shrine will take still like over a minute. Big engagement, Disruptor are boxed in, Force Fields won't help much against the Ultralisk. Yeah, the Disruptor shots, they're not coming at all. But this fight is looking really good for Löblegs. But in the end it's barely not enough. Barely. If Löblegs would have had the same amount of supply as Waffles, he would have won this fight. I guess. Really nicely, but that's not looking good. And Löblegs should know that this is potentially over already. Yeah, there are the Lurker coming. There we go, GG! And Waffles takes game number one in this best of three series. So here we are, game number two on Frozen Temple, spawning in the bottom right hand side as the yellow Protoss playing for the Drunken Outlaws, it is Löblegs. And playing again as the blue Zerg, spawning in the top left hand side of Frozen Temple, it is Waffles. Which was so nice to tell his opponent which race he got. Most people don't do this, and I can understand why, but I think it's really, really nice and mannered to tell your opponent, at least on ladder, maybe not in a tournament, but at least on ladder, what race to play. But we could argue so long about this topic, or on this matter. So hatch first into pool into gas, as it looks like, out of Waffles. There we go. And Löblegs seems to opt for a fairly early nexus here himself. Nice. So nexus should go up right now. There we go, perfect 130, awesome timing. And behind that, core or gate? Core, okay. There's the core. And Löblegs is still scouting here with the probe. That's good. And blocking the third base, look at that. Ah, being so annoying. Wait, what? Where are you going with the drone? Waffles? What? Okay. Scouting with the drone. Ah, he didn't scout it all so far. That's why. Second gas for Löblegs now. And soon we should see either an adept or a stalker being warped in. or at least being produced. There's the adapt. He chronos out the adapt instead of the warp gate tech, which he's still not getting currently. But he's still blocking the third base. Where's the warp gate tech? Come on! Or do you want to go for Stargate? Ah, there you go. It's a bit late. Okay, Waffles is droning up. I don't think the Stalker will get this Overlord kill. The Mothership Core is searching around for anything special, but there is nothing. Still, this probe, so annoying. It's now getting microed a little bit. Ah! Wow, it doesn't get the pylon. Come on, now you can build your hatchery. There we go. And there is the lair tag for Waffles. As I said, the Stalker not finding the kill on the Overlord. Robotics facility out of Lurblix. And another gateway. Okay. And the Roach one for Waffles. So he might go for a Roach Ravager here again. Which would be totally fine. Ooh, a sentry. A sentry is really good in defending. So having a sentry is awesome. That really helps to deny any early aggression. And he's getting a second sentry and an immortal. So with the immortal and the sentry and the additional gateways, he might opt for going for a two base all in. Immortal sentry, which is, even though there's the Ravager, yes, but it's still quite strong. So we will see if Lurblix is going for this kind of style or not. And Waffles so far not droning up. Look at that. He's on 26 drones against 36 probes. Okay, there's a warp prism. And there's a pylon. So he will... he will warp in with the warp prism potentially and not use the robotics facility too much for now. And with the addition of the gates, yes, yes, I do think Lurblix is going for a two-base attack. And if Waffles doesn't scout this, you can see Waffles is going double evolution chamber, droning up heavily, going into Hydralisk then. And this is expensive and takes a long time. So Lurblix might just be able to find a very good timing against Waffles here. I mean, the army supply looks even, but look at that warping. Bam, 10 supply more. And those are adepts. Adepts are strong. Sure, they don't have the resonating glaives, but they are still quite strong. Especially with the sentries, as there are no Ravager at all. So Waffles will see this now. Will he react in time? He needs to produce a lot. He can, he could potentially lose the hatchery, although he wants to keep it alive. But Lurblix seems to just go straight towards the natural and the main base. Oh, nice force field. A little bit misplaced, but still nice there. And yeah, Waffles doesn't have much to defend. The position is good, but most of his units are not attacking. He's just now getting some units. The Spinecrawler dies. The Queen will die as well. Another warp in. The Spinecrawler on top of the ramp. On the edge of the cliff. Will finish up, but will be out of position. Quite a bit. It doesn't really matter. There you go. Nice force field again. And all those units which come out will get killed. This is looking so bad for Waffles here. Look at that. Oh wow. So really nice timing Lurblix finds here. He might just go up the ramp soon. Or he can just kill the hatchery and the natural base and be completely fine as well. Warping even more. One upgrade does finish. The carapace upgrade. still, it's looking very bad for Warfels. And that's Kutche then. They decide to just walk in. And with the Immortal there as well, 15 kills, 16 kills on the Immortal, 17 kills, 18 kills. This Immortal is just a pure boss. And there we go, GG, Liblix takes game number 2. Last game of today, guys, last game of today. And it will be a PvP as you have spawning in the bottom left hand side of Galactic Process, playing for the Drunken Outlaws, just winning the last game. It is Liblix. And he's playing against his opponent, who just dropped the map. The blue Protoss spawning in the top right hand side. It is Warfels. So now we saw two times how good Warfels Zerg is. Let's see how good this Protoss is, especially in PvP. This game could go wild. Mirror matches most of the time can go really fast, really wild. Like CVC, PvP, TVT. Ooh, gas steal attempt! Gets it. Oh, that's so nasty. I don't know about the wall of down here, but this time Warfels didn't tell if he was Zerg or not. So Liblix maybe just assumed it will be Zerg again and went for the wall down here. I don't know if this wall is good against a Protoss player. I really don't know. Look at that. Liblix going with the gate and then core, while Warfels is going into gate core, but he can't get the second assimilator, which he normally wants to have, I guess. So, nice. Okay, double gate finishes up. I think as soon as the core finishes as well, we will see either double adept or double stalker, considering that there is only one gas available. Should be double. Oh, he goes for the nexus first there. Okay. But yeah, adept should be the choice here. Double adept. That's smart, I guess. And Liblix going with the nexus here as well. That's nice. That's really nice. Oh, this probe. Warfels probe attacking Liblix pylon. But the adept should kill it soon. Yeah, evac ASAP. And Warfels is going with the mothership core, while for Liblix there is none so far. Okay. So Liblix is skipping the mothership core for quite some time. There we go. Now adding the mothership core to its arsenal. And moving across the map with those two adapts. There's a proxy pylon being made out of Liblix. I don't think you can warp across the debris here, which is sad. But maybe balance wise it's better as well. Who knows? So now finally the simulator gets taken out. Two adapts against two adapts and a mothership core. But not if you fight like this. Okay. Oh, Liblix might just lose an adept here. Wow! That was unnecessary. Loses a probe as well. Photon overcharge. And Warfels losing an adept himself here. Okay, so what is Liblix doing here with the probe? He's scouting with the probe and the probe gets in. And there's a star proxy stargate. Wow. As I said, this game is gonna go wild. And there's a depth shade. What? Killing quite some probes here. Oh! Misses the one shot. But killing quite some probes. Ah, doesn't get the 6 probe kill there. That's sad. But this Oracle, if it is an Oracle, but it should be. The Stargate potentially producing Oracle could deal so much damage. Yes, there are two Stalk and Photon Overcharge, but there's no pylon right here to defend. No pylon right here to defend, so you could sneak around them. Warfield going now for the robotics and the Twilight as well, while we see a forge out of Lublix, and there's the Oracle. So let's see if the Oracle is done, how much damage the Oracle can find. Potential is there, so maybe Lublix will find a lot of damage, and that would help him out against Warfield. Warfield is ahead a little bit in probes, and getting an edge there would be nice. But so far Waffle's PvP looks quite solid, as well as his PvC. But Lublix is doing a good job as here as well. And this Oracle, there's a second one queued up. The Stalker is heavily out of position. Oracle gets in, one kill, two kills, three kills. Four kills? That's not too bad. The Stalker out of position. And they don't see the Stargate. Ah, now they will find it, but not before the second Oracle finishes up. Ooh, kills the pylon, doesn't go for the Oracle here. Now goes for the Oracle. So some shields are gone already. If you don't lose the Oracle, that is so huge. Gets two kills, three kills. Goes to the main base. But now there are pylons here. Where's the Mothership Core? Where is the Mothership Core? There it is. But the Oracle killed six workers so far. Not bad, not bad. And both Oracles survive, so you can use Revelation or the Stasis Ward. And all of those spells don't cost much energy. So the Oracle can use quite a lot of them. Behind that Lublix, he might just want to take those gases and saturate them and take a Nexus here. But for now he's playing it safe, which is okay. He needs just to spend a little bit more of his money, I feel like. How many gates are there? 5 to 4. One robo to 0. Yeah, Lublix now getting a robo. So the Stargate commitment did help out. He's now up ahead 2 probes. And he got still those 2 Oracle, which is really helpful. It really is helpful. If he uses them for Stasis Ward, Revelation, etc. Warfield's moving across the map with his Stalker. They don't have Blink. Twilight Council does have the Chrono Boost, but it's not producing anything. The upgrade's not looking too good. There are the Stasis Wards. And oh, if he traps the Stalker here. Bam! And another trap. That's so good. Saves those two, but those 6 Stalker potentially might just die. On the other hand, with the reinforcements, who knows? They are in stasis. They cannot move, attack, or be damaged. I do still think that Stalker are better against the Adepts than Adepts are against Stalker. But with the Photon Overcharge here, that's, I would say that was a quite equal trade. Yeah, so far, looking really good. Where are the double Oracles? Right on top of this army. Okay. But Wolfens is doing one thing really nicely here. He's taking another base while putting some pressure on Lublix. And Lublix is not confident enough to get his third base himself. Currently. Which he definitely needs. He can stick on two base and go for an all-in. Or he can take another base, which he wants to do right now, maybe? But there's the warp prism, and might just warp in a bunch of adepts. There we go, 5 adepts. They don't have the resonating glaives, but still, they will find damage. They definitely will find damage. There's the Mothership Core, idle on the natural, a counter adept warp in, 5 against 5. But I would still say it's looking, oh yeah, nice evac there. It's looking very good for Waffles. He is up 19 worker now. This is looking so good for him. The army supply is looking good for Lublix, however. and the upgrades as well. So if he takes a really good fight here, he might just win. Guardian Shield pops way too late, but the Immortal, 3 Immortal, dealing so much damage. The Warp Prism, evac, oh, gets just one sentry there. And all those Stalker are trapped, they don't have Blink, they will die. So you have to trade. And now Loeplix is in a really nice position. If only he would now move across the map, take a third base, and do the same stuff Waffles just tried against him. Which he is currently doing. He got the plus one upgrade, which is good. There's the third base. Uh-oh. I do think Waffles is in a lot of trouble. Oh, the barrier of this Immortal popped already. Now it's on cooldown for 40 seconds. That's also not helpful. There are no cannons, only one pylon. One sentry, but the units are already marching up the ramp. And this is not looking good. The concave, however, is good for Waffles. Okay, and Loeplik's not committing here. I think he could have gone for it, but yeah, killing the destructible and potentially taking out the third base is a good move as well. If he would do it, come on. Ooh, Dark Templar. Okay. DT Shrine. Oracle are moving in. There you go, killing the destructible. That's so important. You need to do this. You have to do this. Nice. And now go up. The Oracle killing so many probes. Wow. And now with the Oracle and he sees the army, he can move in. There's the pincer move, but there is the pylon. Oh wow. Pylon overcharge. A little bit too late, but he didn't pylon overcharge the one which was on the front. That was a good move. Oh, this Immortal runs into a bunch of adepts. Not A moving, gets killed here. And now Waffles has a lot of trouble. Oh, the double upgrades get denied. That's so huge. That would have helped so much, but I think Loeplix just has too much here. Look at the supply. He's tracking Waffles here with his army. I don't think Waffles can hold on any longer. Dark Templar Shrine will finish up soon as well for Loeplix. And both bases are under attack. That is so massive. Okay, Waffles stabilizes finally. And Waffles got DTs himself, and there are, wow, there are no observer out for Loeplix. Awesome. They will kill all of this. So Waffles can potentially still win this. Those DTs did so much. Yes, it does hurt that he lost the base. But maybe he can do it. The stasis wards could be so massive. And there is an observer here. Oh, no, I don't think Waffles can do this. I'm so sorry. The trap triggers. The first cannon, however, gets killed, and the second one will get killed after this as well. The other DT is heading towards the main base. There is one cannon killing this DT. The flank from behind. DT is in the main base. But there's the observer. It is with the army. And Waffles only has those three Dark Templar and the Warp Prism now here to apply any damage or pressure. If only he could snipe the one Immortal Overseer Observer there. And kill the double Robo, but that's very unlikely. There's a cannon. The adepts will do massive damage against the Dark Templar. There's a cannon as well at the third base. Another counterattack out of Loeplix. And what do we have here to defend? One lonely Immortal. No Dark Templar, nothing. No Blink Stalker. No Adept himself. I think Waffles will lose this. He will face elimination any second now. The last Immortal dies. Desperate Warp in with a bunch of DTs. Yes, they are nice, but there's one observer there. And Adept just deals so much damage. And I think there we go. GG, well played, good luck. Loeplix wins this game number 3. Awesome. Okay guys, with that said, That's it for today. The rest of the tournament, semifinals and finals, will be casted tomorrow. I will upload the VOD on my YouTube channel as well, so make sure to subscribe there if you like, and then we see us hopefully tomorrow. I wish you a very nice day and goodbye. Heyo there, thank you for watching. If you'd like to support me, simply hit the thumbs up button. Do you have any wishes, feedback or suggestions, put them into the comments below. You may also subscribe if you're new to the channel. I wish you a wonderful and stress-free day. Take care, bye bye. Thank you.